IMSA.com are joining us on the IMSA TV stream. We're in beautiful Wisconsin. Lakesides and fabulous countryside combining to make a beautiful destination any time of the year. However, when it's race season, it's even better. Road racing is at the very heart of this area of Wisconsin. It used to be on the public roads, but since the 1950s, it's been around the 4.048 miles of Road America. The circuit has changed not at all since it was first laid down. One of the few in America that can boast that proud fact. And we've come down from Connecticut to Road America. 14 corners, 4 miles around. Action areas, turn one, turn five, turn eight just before the signature corner, the carousel, and then at the end of the super quick run down to Canada corner. We've also seen a few passes put in as well through the kink going into the final corner. The topography of this place, Jeremy, is what sets it apart from pretty much anywhere else in the world.
Yeah, I'm not sure there's a better race track for spectating at in the world, possibly the Nürburgring, but I tell you what, I mean, this place is pretty much unrivaled. It is a wonderful place to come and watch motor racing, and it's this new. I got a chance. Thanks for giving me a bit of time off this morning, because I went and watched a warm up and went around that new access area on the kind of driver's right as you're coming down toward Canada Corner, and all that section between there and back to past the kink and to the carousel. And it is just spectacular. You get so many different vantage points, yes, of the cars at this racetrack. That is what makes it stand out for me. It's just a wonderful place. And it is tremendous to see such a great crowd here on hand this weekend. It's a tremendous atmosphere, wonderful place to go racing, and it just gets better and better and better.
Coming through at the end of the first formation lap behind the Corvette pace car as it is now. Let's hope we don't see it as the safety car. Jonathan Bomarito leads Christian Fittipaldi from Ricky Taylor, 55, 5 and 10 with Tom Long. In the second of the Mazdas, he lined up in the outside of the front row. On row three, it'll be Eric Curran who starts the red and white number 31 Action Express car. He'll have Mark Goossens in the blue number 90 Chevy prototype for company. Sean Rahal, fresh from his sprint car outing last night down at Plymouth, had an absolute ball down there. Talked to him at lunchtime at Marion's. Thanks, by the way, Marion and the rest of the team for looking after us this weekend. And already talking about next year, getting driver skills together on the Tuesday and Wednesday. And he's already signed me up. So that's I'm in there for that. And he's talking about doing possibly three race nights next weekend down there.
And hats off for Dr. Don Penos for allowing him to do that, because, you know, sprint car racing isn't the safest option out there for things to do the night before a big race. But Don said, yeah, OK. And hats off also to the IMSA officials. He had to get special dispensation to miss the driver's briefing. He went to the chief steward, Bo Barfield, and said, look, I'd like to miss the briefing. Why? Because I'm going to be racing a sprint car. Heck yes,
I
did a little bit. Go do it, which is wonderful. And real racing and a real racer is Sean Rahal.
And the PC category lines up behind the prototypes in pole position. James French from Sheboygan takes the wheel of the 38 card. He'll see the green flag first of the PC runners in GTLM. It'll be Dirk Muller for the 66 Ford in the inside of the outside of the ninth row. Behind him are the rest of the GTLM field, led by a resurgent 911 Porsche in the hands of Patrick Pele. They've not had a great second half of the season. A couple of decent results in the long races at the early part of the year, but since then they've been in a bit of a slump. And the 911 and the 912 Porsches line up in second and fourth position, with Giancarlo Fisichella in the 62 Risi Competizione Ferrari sitting between them. In GTD, well, pretty much every manufacturer had a crack at pole position, and at one stage, six different manufacturers had the top six positions on the timing and scoring monitor. But Alex Ribéras has emerged at the head of the field to take pole position for the 23 Porsche, the Alex Job Heart of Racing team. Andrew Davis and Matt Bell, the two Audis, second and third. And then Ben Keating for the 33 Dodge, the Viper Exchange car, in fourth position. Our championship leading 63 Ferrari team. Christina Nielsen in fifth position. Not really having the pace here, that Ferrari. So they'll be on damage limitation this weekend with the Lamborghini of Spencer Pumpelly, the number 16. Watch out though for the 48, the Paul Miller Racing car. They were very fast at the start of the week and the car has looked pretty well balanced. Brian Sellers telling us that they're relatively happy with the car. They just need to find a little more pace from it. But I think over the race distance, Jeremy, they will certainly be in the mix.
I agree. And what a good effort that was by Ben Keating in the Viper, car number 33, qualifying fourth place. That is his best qualifying position of the season. That car always runs well here.
Well, the talking is over. And when the flag drops, the race starts. Side by side up the hill, Jonathan Bomarito, Christian Fittipaldi. The green flag is waved and the Mazda pulls across towards the pit lane side to try and cover off anything. Second Mazda coming through as well. That's Tom Long in the dark red car trying to get third position but can't make it. But Jonathan Bomarito has done the first thing he had to do and that was get to turn one and through it in the lead. And Fittipaldi could not get the Chevy Corvette through into the lead. That's a big moment in the race early on.
Yeah, it's one of the Achilles heels of these lighter P2 cars is to get build their heat into their tyres early on because they're so much lighter than the DP cars. Jonathan Bomarito, a great start. Here are the GT LM cars leading the way as well. That Ford is defending its position too.
As well he should, because Patrick Paley has gone round the outside of turn one, and if he can keep the Porsche on the track somehow, he's going to take the lead, and he sweeps through into the first position. Meanwhile, further back down, his teammates battling to hold on to fourth place as the two Corvettes are hunting in packs three from four. That's Antonio Garcia and Ollie Gavin. But that was an awesome, an audacious move round the outside by Patrick Pele. Dirk Müller did everything he could in the 3.5-litre EcoBoost turbocharged Ford, but could not hold him back, and he's under pressure now from Giancarlo Fisichella for second place.
I think they've finally unlocked the potential of this Porsche for this season. They haven't got it right, I think, up until now, and they're using the tyres from last year, which suit that car a whole lot better. They weren't able to use the tyres they wanted to use, incidentally, at Limebach Park. Oh no, the Spencer Pumpelly spun off. Can he keep it going? He's not in the gravel track, just one wheel.
He's yes. out. That's Phew. Turn five, I think. Six. Certainly early part of the lap. Also noticed as well that Michael Marzel, I think, went very wide. Got a little bit of a tap in the number 97 BMW in the GT Daytona class. Yeah, this time last year, Porsche and all, in fact, of the GTLM runners were using a very different tyre from Michelin. A single stint tyre only. This year, for the whole of the IMSA series, they are using the same medium compound as is available to the WEC, the World Championship runners, which is built for endurance and multiple stints. Porsche have asked if they could go back to the 2015 version of that tyre. They have done, and finally been able to switch that tyre on this weekend. They've been struggling with the balance of the 2015 and a half 911. We wait with bated breath to see what the 2017 car will bring us. A turbocharged engine, pretty much certainly, but it is the position of that engine relative to the gearbox and the rest of the car that will be the headline news. That's for another day, because Jonathan Bomarito is now battling away from the field and just pulling out a second or so's lead on Christian Fittipaldi, who's got Ricky Taylor in behind him, and then Tong Long, 5.55, 10 and 70, the top four.
Yeah, the GTLM there, Dirk Müller, having qualified on the pole, is now back to fifth place. He was overtaken by Patrick Pile around the outside of the first corner, but since then, he's lost three more positions.
Are we going back to what we saw earlier on in the season, where the Ford was very recalcitrant to get up to pace from starts and restarts? The BMWs, who are coming through the field, remember, they had to start right at the back after some infractions in the qualifying session. The number 100 and the 25 car are already almost up to the back of that Ford that started right at the head of the GTLM field. They're coming through the GT Daytona field at the moment, which, by the way, is led by Alex Rebras from pole position. Andrew Davis in the number 6 Audi. Ben Keating up at the third, fourth for Matt Bell in the number 9 Audi. Christina Nielsen holds on to fifth position ahead of Luca Persiani in the 27 Lamborghini. Bill Oberlin, by the way, and Lucas Lehr, who started the two BMWs. And they have picked their way through the majority of the field there. They are now ahead of the number 97 of Michael Marzel and the BMW of Brett Curtis. The 96 car is behind them as well. Oh, the 66 is off the pole sitting Ford. Dirk Müller has overcooked it and is off the side of the circuit. That is a great blow. I don't think he's hit anything, Jeremy. He's just come through Canada corner. He's off to driver's left. And I'm looking at the left front to see if there's damage. There's a little bit. There's been some contact with something now. May have been the wall. There's the panels gaps at the front of that Ford are not as they should be. And there's some rubbing. There's been some rubbing on the right, on the left front of that car. And that car is touring in the yes. pit lane. This is drama early on for Chip Ganassi and the Ford Racing Team with the so far tremendously competitive Ford GT. Damage on the rear diffuser. I wonder if he's had a little tap there and he was helped into that. But he was very slow, Jeremy.
He was, wasn't he? Clearly that car not up to pace as it comes onto pit lane. Seemed to be trading a little bit of fluid as well as it came up the hill there, I thought.
Shea Adam, our Continental Tire pit lane reporter, jumps into action a little earlier than she might have expected, Shea.
To be honest, John, I was expecting action a little bit earlier than that. I just wasn't expecting it to be the 66. He is sitting, the left front is definitely a bit lower than it should be. Dirk Müller is reporting to the team that there is a steering issue and they're, well, I don't see much damage to the diffuser. I am seeing damage to the left front. The team fuels the car before they get anything started. They are checking to make sure that the suspension is not moving around in any way that it should not be. But the damage to the bumper looks mostly cosmetic. It has taken off the front dive planes. Actually, it smushed them up against the rest of the car. They're having issues getting the tool into the nose that they need, but its front suspension is broken, so it's much more than a cosmetic injury.
And problems further back around the track for, it's the same part of the circuit. It is the 85, the JDC prototype challenge car. That's on driver's right coming out of Canada corner. A separate incident, I believe, and it has refired with Misha Goikberg at the wheel, and he's got the 85 car pointing in the right direction. Goikberg with that blue and white racing helmet, and no harm, no foul there. I can't even see any damage on the 85 coming through to the end of the third lap for him. It's Jonathan Bomarito, who's got a couple of seconds lead from Christian Fittipaldi, 55 from 5. The dark red Mazda from the white, black and yellow of Action Express. Then Ricky Taylor in the black Wayne Taylor racing car. The second of the Mazdas, Tom Long, now 5 seconds away from his teammate in fourth position. Then a bit of a gap, second and a half to Mark Goossens in the mid-coloured blue number 90 Visit Florida.com car. Eric Curran in the 31, the red and white Action Express car, holding on to the leaders, only 8 seconds away from the man at the head of the field. In prototype challenge, James French has held on to his pole position as in comes the 77 Porsche right in front of us. And there's a driver change going on early. Gunnar Jeanette's helmet is standing next to the car with Gunnar Jeanette attached to it, I should mention, as out jumps David McNeil. So this is an early change of strategy here. McNeil qualified the car, therefore had to start it. Now, has he got a problem? Or are they just doing something to get off strategy? They look like they're struggling a little bit. I don't think this was accounted for. And that car is down and away very quickly. Gunnar was helmeted at least. But that is surely a change in tactics for the 77 Porsche, which will now drop it to the back of the field. Well, What a first couple of laps, Jeremy. We promised excitement. Scott Atherton said on the grid it was going to be an exciting 2 hours and 40 minutes. It's lived up to it so far.
He wasn't lying, was he?
No.
And here comes the number 77 car. The pit's just in front of the GTLM leader. Good job there, staying out of the way. Gunnar Jeanette, of course, we expect nothing different. And but that's a good battle going on. GTD, a little bit of a lead now for Alex Rebras. He's pulled out just a bit over a good battle for second place with Andrew Davis and Ben Keating, who's moved up a position in the early stages of the race.
Shea Adam has an update from the 77, so perhaps not such an unexpected stop.
No, not entirely, because David McNeil and Gunnar Jeanette are not in the championship battle for the number 77. They are doing this race because it is the McNeil's home event. This is a track that they dearly love. So David came into this race. He did his laps already around the track. He does not need to meet a minimum drive time. We could see Gunnar Jeanette behind the wheel of the 77 for the rest of this race.
Thank you, Shea. Connell Tire Pit Report there. So the right front suspension broken for Dirk Müller in the number 66 Ford. That is the big headline early on. And they've dropped down to 41st position. One of the major contenders in GTLM is out before we've even got into our stride. Patrick Peeler leads by just 0.6 of a second down the Canada corner for the Porsche number 911. Fizzy in the 2016 488 Ferrari. A little quieter than the model it replaces. Turbocharged, of course, and making full advantage of the 2016 aerodynamic regulations, which the Porsche cannot because of the position of its engine. They've increased the size of the diffuser at the back of the car. But in doing so, I think they've lost something from the balance of the car between last year and this. But at the moment, they've found the pace that they've been looking for. You have found the pace you are looking for. In the 911 and the 912, both up at the sharp end of the field, first and third in the hands of Patrick Peeley and Earl Bamber. Antonio Garcia in fourth position leads the Corvette charge. And there'll be plenty of Corvette drivers who will be waving their bow tie flags, with Ollie Gavin sitting in just behind him in fifth position in GTLM. And that lead button heads down to turn number five now. Over the top of the brow, get the car straight, try and get it settled. And the Ferrari way later on the brakes, too much later on the brakes, as Giancarlo Fisichella closed up at an alarming rate to the back of Patrick Peeley's Porsche. But had to pull to one side, and that has allowed Earl Bamber a chink of light as he heads towards a challenge perhaps for second position in the pit lane. One of the Mazdas, well, it must be the 70 car, because I saw the 55 going through, and Tom Long is in early on. Shea Adam is our Continental Tire pit lane reporter, and as ever, is on the spot.
He's doing a drive-through for some reason, John. I'll figure out why, but he did not stop in his pit box.
Thank you, Shea. Must have been a jump start then, or something similar. For that to, looks like he wants to go into, no, he's gone behind the wall. He's gone behind the wall. So this is another real contender at the front of the field, this time of the overall in prototype, and an early issue for the number 70. And Mazda's cruel luck with fast motor cars continues as we are barely 15 minutes to just 13 minutes into this 2 hour and 40 minute encounter here on the 4 miles of Road America. Jeremy Sean, John Hindhoff in the broadcast booth, live from Road America, just to the left of the starter stand as the drivers come through. And another spin at turn number five, and another PC car.
One of the bar one cars. Identical.
Both of them, in fact.
Are you kidding?
Yes. So it was the 26 has just stopped. Am I seeing double? Or has he just stalled it as he tried to loop it around? Is the bar one car, as Jeremy rightly says. Don Yount coming down the hill alongside Oh, and just locked the rear wheels in the downchange. No, it was the 20. I'll take that back. He hit the something on the inside, which was full of water. That would have been tyres. What did he hit there? That was extraordinary. And he's now come to a halt. Right on the exit of turn five. He's got to get that fired and get it moved. He's in a very dangerous position indeed. So, Matt McMurray of the 20. He's trying to fire it up. I can see the lights on the side of the car going on and off. Engine issue. Engine issue for the number 70 as we predictably get a full course caution with the leader charging towards the bar one car, which is stranded at the exit of turn number five. And the 66 is back out on the circuit, so suspension damage on the front of that car has been fixed by the Chip Ganassi Ford Racing mechanics, and that car heads back into the race having lost some six laps on the leader in class. So what happened there to the bar one car, still stranded on the outside? Bump start might get it started is the body language from the marshals who have got down there. Very great appreciation of all of our corner workers, marshals, recovery crews and volunteers both trackside and beyond, and particularly here at Road America, where all of our food concessions are staffed by members of local charities. So when you eat the great food here at Road America, you also support great causes around the Elkhart Lake area. You're listening to IMSA Radio live from trackside at Road America on IMSA.com, the IMSA app, the RSL networks, and on XM Sirius. We're in our first full course yellow. So take a breath. Jonathan Bomarito will be disappointed to see his 2 second gap evaporate. It'll be a quick caution in terms of getting the car out of the way. Now, have we gone through 15 minutes? I don't think we have when that caution came out. It's going to be tight. There's a place that you can pull that car back into the paddock at turn five, and a nice job done by the recovery team with their Chevy truck using the tow hitch on the front of the car to the back of the number 26. It was the 26. I was right the first time, so it was Don Yount in that car, not Matt McMurray. And Don trying to get it restarted, and it's not playing at the moment. So he's talking to the safety workers down there at turn five. Well, plenty of action and excitement, Jeremy Shaw, and another suspension failure. Now, we've seen that in other categories throughout the weekend, Jeremy, and you've got to say, one of our IHG Rewards Club keys to the race, stay on the track and off the curbs. And I didn't see any side-to-side contact there that might have caused that suspension damage. So unless it was a failure, which would be not unheard of, but quite unusual, you've got to think that the guys have been pushing a little bit too hard.
Yeah, I mean, I have no idea what happened down there, but it was certainly odd that the number 20 car spun as well.
Yes, it was too. It was both cars.
It was both cars.
My eyes weren't deceiving myself. It was a synchronized spinning by the Gas Monkey Garage, sponsored by One Cars. So the wave by of cars between the leader and their class leader starts, which would suggest to me we are going to open the pits. So Jonathan Bomarito has to be very chilled as cars go by. Just in case you're wondering, the IMSA race control does not read out a whole load of numbers. Basically, they set it up, tell the leader to stay to one side of the track or another, normally on a long straight, of which we have a couple here, which are perfect for the wave bys. And then all of the car pits to car radios get the same message, which is the wave by starts now. If you are eligible, please do it.
Yeah, and this is certainly good news, particularly for the number 77 car, which had made that early pit stop, handed over from David McNeil to Gunnar Jannetty. It was still on the lead lap, so it's going to take him a while to catch up because he's going to go past a whole bunch of cars that were way behind the safety car in any case, and then go around and then go around again. But that's the way the things are set up. So it certainly plays into their strategy. It also helps the cars that started at the back of the grid, for example, the two BMWs in GTLM and a number 67 Ford GT. They'd all start at the back, they'd worked their way all through all the GTD cars. That had taken quite a while, so they were a long way behind the other top five cars in GTLM. Now they've been able to catch up.
Yeah, so we have the top eight GTLMs lying astern on the timing and scoring monitor from 15th down to 22nd. And separated once they close up under the safety car by not very much at all. As good as Jannet has to weave his way through the prototypes, who have been less than helpful there, trying to keep their tyres warm. Sean Rahal did a good job in the Delta Wing, sixth position for him. Pugh just holding on to the leaders as well. Dropped down to eighth position in the number 60. Michael Shank racing Ligier with the Honda engine.
It certainly helps him as well. It helps that team enormously, right, because he'd lost a fair bit of ground to the other leaders. But James French, what a job he'd been doing there. The local guy from Sheboygan, Wisconsin, the car number 38 for Performance Tech Motorsports. He'd left the field well behind. He was about 5.5 seconds clear of Robert Alonso, also had done well to move himself up from ended up being fourth on the grid. He qualified fifth, but number seven car was put to the back. So he'd made up a couple of positions in the early stages of the race as well. That's Robert Long in car number 52 for PR1 Matheson Motorsports. And he is now just ahead of the championship leader. That is Alex Popo in car number 8 for Starworks Motorsports.
Yeah, just underlining as I'm looking through some social media here when we get a moment at IMSA Radio, by the way, if you'd like to get in touch with us here in the broadcast centre. The Chip Ganassi Racing confirming no contact on track before the report from Dirk Müller of that suspension issue on the 66 Ford GT. So we've gone through 10 minutes, 12 minutes gone now. 20 minutes gone now, sorry. 2 hours 40 we started with, didn't we? Jonathan Bomarito still leads. Ollie Gavin behind the wheel of the fifth place Chevy Corvette GTLM. Ollie had a bit of bad news from home at the weekend. Someone broke into his house. All the family are fine, but the thieves made off with some racing memorabilia, including some Le Mans medallions for his driving there and driver's helmets. So, as we have a large audience of motorsport fans, presumably the thieves will want to make some money out of them by selling them. Please keep your eyes open on any auction sites, not just in the UK, of course. And report anything you see to the appropriate authorities. Be able to get Ollie some of his precious memorabilia back. It's nothing but ill will to the people who did it. Shit, Adam, down in the pit lane.
I'm not going to be getting visited by anyone this time, John, because it's just a quickie yellow, so the pits will not open before the green flag comes back out.
Okay, so they've reset the field, but not opening the pits. Thank you, Shit. Thank you to the IMSA officials for passing that on to our Continental Tire pit lane reporter. So Jonathan Bomarito will have had that news as well on the Pits to Car radio. 156.004 on lap 5, the fastest lap we've had so far in the race.
And what Shay's talking about there, the quickie yellow, if there aren't 15 minutes of green since the start or restart, then we don't go through all the pit lane opening procedures after that. They just reset the field so that nobody gets disadvantaged by the timing of this full course caution. I think we've done about 14 minutes of green before that yellow came out.
I did say I thought it was going to be close. Yes, absolutely. Race lap record here, Jeremy?
Race lap record here is 155.166.
Okay, so about a second away.
Race lap record, because it's 57.094 by Joao Barbosa a couple of years ago. Fastest lap last year, 157.464. And
Jonathan Bomarito has broken that lap record substantially, 156.004.
Yeah, and
yes,
and
I thought so.
Each of the first five laps of the race, he was the quickest, quickest car out there. And even as early as lap three, he had set the fastest lap and then improved it again two times more than that. So 156.004, fastest lap race by Jonathan Bomarito. But Spirit, other guys were quick as well.
As we go back to green flag racing with 2 hours and 16 minutes almost on the nose, Jonathan Bomarito gets a decent start again with Christian Fittipaldi. This time, has he learned something from that first start? As they head down through turn number one, it's still in PC category. James French, the young man from Sheboygan, able to go home cooking this weekend. Lots of family and friends of James here, I know. Big fan club for him this weekend. So Bomarito needs to get his concentration back up again. He will have turned everything to full lean, saving fuel, GTLM battle. Porsche Corvette ahead of the Ferrari. That's a change since the restart then. And, well, in fact, no, we've got Porsche has got ahead of the Corvettes and the Ferraris. It's Porsche 1 and 2. I thought we'd look at it first, second and third, but Pelé has cleared off and Earl Bamba is the one who's got ahead of the Ferrari. And Antonio Garcia must have followed him through. It was Porsche, Ricci Ferrari, Porsche Corvette, and now we have Porsche, Porsche Corvette, Ricci Ferrari, and Ollie Gavin still in fifth position.
Wow, yeah, that is
shuffle.
Interesting, isn't it? Big shuffling there, and now got the BMWs and the remaining four GT in that thick of that as well. Let's have a look, see what happened here. Oh,
well, Fizzy went off at turn three.
Exactly what you were talking about earlier on.
Keys to the race, our IHG rewards could please stay on the track because the curbs can hurt you. Bounce the back wheels of the Ferrari off the ground. And as good as Ferrari are, and as good as Michelin tyres are, if they're not in contact with the ground, Jeremy, you're not going to get forward progress.
No, and all that force that goes through the wheel when it hits that bump on the other side of the dip, if you like, that's a tremendous force there. It can easily cause major problems.
I keep a look on the left rear of that Ferrari 488. Because it may just be my eyes, but I think it is sitting a bit lower on that left rear corner. Might just be a little bit of an optical illusion as they climb the hill in the GTLM battle. 15th down over. Patrick Pelé completes his 11th lap. And Earl Bamber in second place. And down at the Porsche Platz, the Porsche owners will be loving this. Fighting back through the field, the BMWs and the Ford. Now, right with Ollie Gavin, fifth to eighth, 16 wheels of GTLM action. And into the pit lane, Paul Miller Racing and the Lamborghini. Now, this is going to be a driver change. Shea Adam is watching.
Brian Sellers sprints off the pit wall, and Madison Snow is getting out of the car. Four new Continental sticker tires will be going on the 48. No, it was not a driver change. It was an illusion. They are doing a water bottle change. Brian Sellers not being put into action yet. Fuel still going into the car, lowered off of its air jacks. Nice burnout, Madison, I have to say. That was a bit off strategy, but remember, in our IHG countdown to green, Brian Sellers did tell us the tire wear on this car is a bit more severe than some others. Let me look over these Continentals, John, and I'll let you know how they look.
That's the third time in four races, if I'm not mistaken. Number 48 car has come in really early for Madison Snow for something sort of, you know, not kind of normal, isn't it? And I don't know what's going on there.
They will need a splash at some time, but surely you've got to expect, well, maybe you don't expect, but you've got to play the deck you've been given. They've just come in off a full course yellow, and they might think that maybe one more pit stop they can get to the end from there.
No, you can't do much more than an hour around here. Yeah, very much. They'll need cautions, that's for sure.
Shit, Adam.
Brian Sellers just assured me they're okay. He was not going to get into the car anyway. That was a strategy call. They're mixing it up early.
Okay, well, make the cautions count, we said. Okay. Didn't quite mean it like that, but they've seen something that perhaps other people haven't on their spreadsheet. The engineers will be working really, really hard. Fisichella battling back now after his little mistake at turn three. That's where they are now, the diving turn at the bottom of the hill past the Briggs and Stratton sign that hangs over the track. It's been there for as long as I can remember. Mind, I haven't got a very good memory, in fairness. Who are you? Pomerino's pulled away, Jeremy. He's got a good job again on the restart, and he's just been nailing these laps. You don't have to be massively quicker than everybody else. A couple of tenths here, and all of a sudden he's amassed 2.5 seconds of a lead.
That's right, we did it on that first lap of Greener. 156.03 was that first lap after Greener. That was within 0.03 of his new track record here. So he's got the hammer down. He wants to build up that margin again. Just going back to whether or not that driver change would or could or should have taken place, it shouldn't, because the silver rated drivers here for GTD have to do a minimum of 50 minutes of drive time. In PC, oddly, they have to do a minimum of 60 minutes of drive time. In order to be classified, that's how much each driver has to do a minimum of.
The other early pit caller was the number 77 Porsche. David McNeil got out of that car. Could have Jeanette got in? Here's Cher Adam.
That was a bit of strategy call, was it not, David, for Gunner to get into the car so early, or are you planning to get back into the 77?
Well, right now, we've got the most fuel of any GTD car, and we got lucky. Sometimes it's better to be lucky than good, but we got lucky, and Gunner's fantastic as a driver, so he's got the most fuel of any GTD car, and the double yellow allowed him to catch up to the pack. So now he's just going to work his way through the pack as only Gunner can. So it's a fantastic strategy. We've got more fuel than anybody, and we'll see how this all works out as it plays out through the race.
We'll have to keep our eyes on the 77.
Well, it has worked nicely for them. There's no doubt about that. Making the cautions count was one of our IHG Rewards Club keys to the race. As David McNeil said there, couldn't have planned for that, but it has worked out in favour of the 77 car. Christian Fittipaldi is beginning to get into his stride here, puts in the fastest first sector of the race. That's from the start line to just about the braking area for turn number five. And he's gained a wee bit, but not much, 0.3 seconds.
Yeah, what's significant about that, I think, is the straight line speed of that car that we've seen, particularly during the warm-up. That car is trimmed out. It's set to go fast in the straights. That's why he's quick in that first sector. Most of that first sector is long straights.
And he's being pushed along, in fairness, Jeremy, by Ricky Taylor, who's to within a second of second position. They're coming round on the start-finish line now. So the mainly white prototype in second position. Jonathan Bomarito goes through and completes his 14th lap. Then the rumble, the low rumble of the Corvette prototype, Fittipaldi, Taylor and Goossens only a couple seconds further back, and Eric Curran right with Mark Goossens again now as he goes round the 48 with Madison Snow going into turn one. That slightly compromised his entry to turn one in that 31 Action Express car. This is really interesting at the front of the field. Still to have our first pit stops from the leaders, remember, in prototype challenge. It's still the 38 of James French by 4 seconds. He's checking out. And in GT Le Mans, coming past our broadcast position now at the top of the hill, Pele has been caught by Bamba, who's brought Giancarlo Fisichella for company. So Fisichella back up into third. So the Ferrari had dropped back a bit, but now is pressuring the Ford. And it's three and four in fourth and fifth for the Corvettes. So that was a change out on the circuit as Fisichella, after that mistake at three, got back past Antonio Garcia and now wants the second place he had earlier on, back from Earl Bamba. How dare the Kiwi take it from him? Fisichella really on a charge now, has put in two or three very good laps, and he can be barely seen behind the more upright profile of the Porsche 911. Down into turn five, comes out of the slipstream, goes for the inside, gets it to the corner. Can he stand it up? He can't. And makes the corner and goes back to second. And Ricci with the Ferrari and Giancarlo Fisichella, the 488, the turbocharged prancing horse, is back into second position and sets off immediately in hot pursuit of the leader. Pulls two or three cars lengths. So that car coming into its own with still over 2 hours and 5 minutes to go. Further back down the GTLM field, Ollie Gavin has got his hands full because Ryan Briscoe is half a second behind him. Then Bill Oberlin is half a second behind him. And Lucas Lowe is a tenth of a second behind his teammate. Misha Goikberg, by the way, is working his way through this in the 85 car after that spin earlier on, recovering. And he's got the difficulty of fighting back through that field. Meantime, in GT Daytona, we've had some action for 9th and 10th position between the 22 Porsche and the 97 BMW. 22 Porsche's got Cooper McNeil at the wheel and Michael Marcel behind the wheel of the 97 BMW. They were trading pit coming through turn 30.
And up front of the field, a new track record again there for Jonathan Bobberita, 155.994.
Wow, and indeed wow. In the old LMS days, the P2 cars with lots more power and downforce were quicker than that. I know people are tweeting that in, but that is a lap record for the current iteration of IMSA. But that is not slow at all around here. The Mazdas have got a bit of history around here. 44 Audi of John Potter, now in behind Cooper McNeil, 9th and 10th for those cars as they crest the brow of the hill and go past us. The 96 BMW just ahead of them is the other Turner Motorsport car, Brett Curtis.
Yeah, and John Potter is hanging on nicely there as well with that group.
Jeremy, he's doing really well. He's just gone by Michael Marcel. Fairness, Michael had made a mistake when he was trying to make a position, but you've got to be there to take advantage of it. 155.7 for Jonathan Bomarito. Well, there's no sense at all that the Speed Source Mazda is lifting the pace at all, or easing the pace in terms of having a 5 second lead at the front of the field. Ricky Taylor sitting in third position is still gently closing down on Christian Fittipaldi in second. 5, 55 and 10. Mazda, Chevrolet. Mark Goosens in fourth position, holding on. 57.5 for him last time around. Got to keep those guys in sight. Eric Curran keeping him on the straight and narrow with a 57.2 last time around. Closed down to within 6/10 of a second as the GTLM battle continues. And second place has just gone the way of the 62 Ferrari, and he had a little go for the lead as well on Patrick Pele. Well, I did say that Fisichella was trying very hard and looked the car most likely claimed back in second place from Bam, and he's gone through into the lead, but Pele's nipped that one back. It was turn five, and again Fizzy just leaving his braking a tad late. That's a couple of times he's done that, and Pele was able to get it back. But he's now right back on the rear bumper of the 911 Porsche. This time, the Ferrari has got the draft. He's got the hole in the air. Same part of the circuit. Pele defends to the inside. He's got to stay there now and try and force the Ferrari the long way around. But it's the old over and under. Fizzy knows that one very well. Gets great drive off the corner as they head up the hill under the Corvette Bridge. Dives to the inside at six. Oh, very close. But manages to just tuck in behind Patrick Pele. All of this battling between the Porsches and the Ferrari has allowed the fourth place car of Antonio Garcia into the mix, and the top four in GTLM at the moment separated by less than a couple of seconds. In fact, make that the top five because Ollie Gavin's there. Oh, wait a minute, just make that the whole field. Yeah. Because Ryan Briscoe has got ahead now of Ollie Gavin, and then it's Bill Oberlin and Lucas Lowe. 77 back in the pit lane with steam coming out the back of the car. New set of Continentals about to go on, but the battle is at the lead of the GTLM category as they head down towards Canada Corner. good amount of spectators on driver's right on that new walkway and golf cart track as they're taking in the exceptional viewing opportunities here at Road America, confirmed at the head of the grid in our countdown to green here on IMSA Radio by Scott Atherton. A long-term relationship with Road America and cementing its future on the calendar of the IMSA racing schedule. Lot of hot brake smell from the Porsche number 77 being reported from our Continental Tire pit lane reporter Shea Adam. He joins in the mix here as the leaders are coming round. Leaders in GTLM are coming round turn one, and Goitberg is trying to fight his way through this battle, and I don't think Antonio Garcia will be overly pleased with where Misha is putting his car at the moment. But I understand Misha's trying to get back through the traffic. He's got the leading trio in GTLM, which is Porsche, Ferrari, Porsche, 911, 62, and 912. Yeah, Jeremy, say something so I can take a breath.
Well, yeah, you know, I mean, GTLM is absolutely fantastic. I mean, that, there is nothing to choose between any of those guys. Interesting to me that number 77 car came onto pit lane again. And there's another five car. Oh, onto pit lane. Okay, it's a roundabout due for pit stops here. We're only 40 minutes into the race, but they can go no more than that. Particularly, we had two pace laps here. That's 8 miles. So that is why we're seeing pit stops at this relatively early stage in the race. Both of the Action Express cars are in right now. We also saw number 77 car come onto pit lane a few moments ago. And the number 77 car, yeah, that pitted earlier on, if you remember. So another splash of fuel there, but still able to get out there without losing a lap to the GTD class leader. So again, good strategic call there from Alex Job Racing. And when everybody else comes into pits in GTD, which I would expect in another 10 minutes or so, then you might well even cycle through to the lead of the race.
Two Action Express cars are in. Shea Adam has this Continental Tire pit lane report.
Two Action Express drivers have gotten out of the two Action Express cars. The five has already gone back out. They did tires and fuel on both cars. The 31 now has Dean Cameron as he just steams out of the pit lane. Only car left with me now, John, is the Delta Wing. Did not see a driver change going on to that one.
Just to underline, it was a full service for the 77 Porsche, the Alex Job Racing car, Jeremy. Did take on new tyres, and Shea reporting a smell of very hot brakes when that 77 went back out. I just wonder if they've used up their tyres a little bit too much earlier on. But again, they're staying off strategy. But our IHG Reward Club keys to the race is that it's a long lap, and you can use that, and they have done. The battle for GTLM continues to excite us, and Misha Goitberg's got the best seat in the house at the moment, looking at second in front of him and then first, just about another 5 metres up the road as Giancarlo Fisichella goes down the inside at turn number six, gets alongside, little bit of a tap off on the side of the road, oh, onto the grass there from Pele. Pele gave him room on the apex of the corner. I don't think he'd be overly happy. He's weaving left and right now to clean the dirt from his Michelin tyres. Fizzy sort of went for it, thought better of it, and then went for it again. There was two moves there. Not sure he'd have got the touchdown. A secondary motion might have been called there. But Fizzy Keller is through. Both cars taking an awful lot of speed under the Corvette Bridge and through the left-hander at the top of the hill there through turn number six, as the 60, John Pugh, comes in with just on 2 hours to go. Shea Adam will keep an eye on that.
Yeah, that will be a driver change as well.
Driver, four tyres and fuel. So, just a chance to have another look. He's on the curb, Fisichella. Well, it's very fair by Pele. Gave him the room and then ran out of room on the exit himself. Pele didn't pull in to the side of the Corvette, checked himself up. Did he leave? Jeremy Shaw, Was there enough room left by Fizzy as he went to the outside of the corner? Pele did the right thing, no doubt. I don't know. It's a hard one to call either way. I could.
He didn't leave him any room, that's his edge. Or whether he needed to do, I don't know.
Yeah. I could see that being called either way. I could see that being a no call. I could see it being a call. It was for the race lead in that class. Shea Adam, give us an update.
It was a perfectly clean stop for the Michael Schenck Racing guys, just what we expect from them. And Oz taking no extra time to get back out onto the track. He leaves a nice little bit of Continental rubber on the pit lane, which my shoes just stuck to.
Thanks, Shea. Under 2 hours to go now. Jeremy Shaw and John Heindorf, hello there, in our broadcast booth, just to drivers left of the start-finish line. And the first 45 minutes have been pretty full on.
Yeah, interesting to me that the number, particularly number 10 and number 90 cars go a lot farther than the Action Express cars chose to go on this first stint of fuel. I'd certainly expect to see them in next time around, however, for their first scheduled service of the day.
Big crowd here at Road America. Do notice from the overhead shots that many of the tents and camping trailers have been packed away, ready for a quick getaway at the end of the race. It is a little bit later in the afternoon than we normally race here in Wisconsin. Local time coming on to 10 minutes before 4 o'clock in the afternoon. The area around the kart track, you couldn't move there yesterday for campers, but they've got themselves ready to leave. So it's going to be a bit of a scramble out on the local roads. I have to say, though, it is always well managed out of this racetrack. Following our race today, for listeners on RadioLeMond.com and IMSA.com, we will have Michelin Post Race Tech. We'll be looking for your Spirit of the Race Award nominees. And we'll also be looking to take your questions, queries, and points of order, matters arising, call it what you will. The hashtag is MichelinPRT to at IMSA Radio on Twitter, please. First and second are in the pit lane. Strategy counts here. Seconds count. Our IHG Rewards Cup keys to the race. Get your fuel numbers right and make sure that you get your pit stops clean. Seconds count in the pit lane as they do on the track. Shea Adam.
And Mazda has been working diligently over the last month since they had their race at Canadian Tire Motorsport Park to try and perfect the pit stop. They have come up with a new strategy, changing the left front and right rear, and then doing the right rear and left front. Now they've got it totally done on the first step. That was very well orchestrated. They keep the mechanics out of each other's way. They are working on the right front. Fuel still going on. Tire change is now complete. Car is down. Fuel still going in. Engine revved, and Tristan Nunez leaves his pit box. That was the best pit stop I've seen from Mazda all year long. The 10 car has finished its stop as well. Fuel going in. They are now clear to go back out. That is a Taylor brother behind the wheel. I can't tell you which one because I didn't see if there was a driver change or not. Mazda leaves with the gap it came in with. Four new tires as well for Wayne Taylor Racing, as well as the Visit Florida team.
Jordan Taylor behind the wheel of the 10 car. Mark Goossens has swapped over to Ryan DL in the number 90. James French leads the motor race. Local lad leading his race in the prototype challenge class, courtesy of the fact he hasn't pitted yet. And again, his family members will be taking pictures of the timing and scoring monitors in the areas that they're watching at the moment. That's a great local story. It won't last, of course, but nevertheless, I hope somebody takes a snapshot of that right now. Got to say, I thought Shea was absolutely right there, Jeremy. That is one of the best stops I've seen from Speed Source. They had the wheels and tyres changed for four new Continentals long before the fuel had stopped going in.
Yeah, let's hope so, certainly, because that's what they've lacked in the past. However, he's still come out behind number 5 car on that first round of pit stop, and probably number 10 car as well. I'm not quite sure where they are.
No, he got out ahead of both of those cars. The 5 car hasn't stopped yet. Yes, it has. Yeah. Need to see when they go through the pit stop.
Right now, he's just ahead of the 31 cars, number 55. So
that's sixth position. Jordan Taylor and Ryan DL are ninth and tenth. with John Bennett in between them. They're quite a way back down the road, so we'll see when they go through the next stop. I think they're about 2.7 seconds behind the five car. So that was a very quick turnaround and a good outlap by João Barbosa. And Tristan Nunes needs to be right on the money very quickly. He's come out into a little bit of GT traffic. The 27 Lamborghini comes in from seventh in GTD. Luca Persiani behind the wheel there. Here comes the leader. Check that. Here comes the car, the lead prototype car. Charles Barbosa, as James French comes in the lead into the pit. Robert Allon is the man that now leads the PC cars, the prototype challenge cars, now cycling through the pit. Yeah?
There will be no driver change yet for the 38. James French, the hometown hero, gets to drive for a little bit longer, but they are giving him a lot more fuel, a full tank's worth, and some new Continental tires. Fuel is still going in. The tire change has been completed for a couple of seconds now. Fueling is done. Car dropped down off the jacks, and James French comes back out toward the fast lane, which is pretty much where he's a happy camper. But, John, we're not done with our pit stops yet, because within the next couple of laps, we're going to see the Porsches coming in. There will be a driver change for the 912. Fred Macko is sitting on the box with his helmet on. Nick Tandy still does not have his on as of right now, so Patrick Pile's day isn't done quite yet.
Just talking to the Porsche teams over the weekend about tyre changes, which is now about 14, 15 seconds with one gun over the wall, remember, not the 21 people that we see in Formula One and other open wheel racing. I mean, they're spectacular. 2 seconds pit stop for all four wheels and tyres. But the immense amount of skill and coordination it takes for the guys to run around the car and do four wheels and tyres on these prototypes and on the GT cars. I marvel at it that they can do that in 15, 16 seconds. 27 car goes back out the pit lane, by the way. Cedric Spirazzoli has been plugged into that one. Persiani's done his driving. Cedric getting a good look at the track this morning when he was out in the Lamborghini Super Trofeo, North America. All right with that as well. Won't spoil that for you. Watch that on CBS Sports in the coming weeks, if you haven't already seen it on IMSA.TV. Leading in GT Daytona, Alex Ribeiras in the 23 AJR Heart of Racing machine, and he's been doing a pretty good job throughout the 50 minutes or so that we've been racing. Meantime, the WeatherTech number 22, his teammate, is battling with a BMW. That is the 96 of Brett Curtis. Pit stops for GT Daytona now, including the 63 car. Shea Adam.
We've already had Christina Nielsen out of the 63. Alessandro Balzan installed behind the wheel of that Ferrari. 52 has come in, and Robert Alon, I believe, stayed behind the wheel of that, the 7 PC car as well. But more importantly for championship, for the 44 GTD, the Audi, Andy Lally will get behind the wheel of that car. He is being belted in right now. They have already finished the tire change. They are working on the driver change, but fuel's still going on. So no additional time lost as of right now. Fueling still going on, although they're still having issues. Now the door closes of the number 44. Earl Bamber has snuck up on me. He has jumped out of the 912. That's the sound of the Audi going back out in the background. 97 has come in. That's Marcus Paltola behind the wheel of that BMW now. Earl Bamber slams the door of the 912 as Fred Macko is finishing getting his belts all in order. Fuel still going into the 912, and the 911 will not be far behind it as that crew is up on the wall. Macko does a beautiful burnout and heads out the pit lane, and directly across from me, John Edwards is standing on the wall, so he will be taking over the number 100 for Lucas Lohr within the next lap. As further down the pit lane, I can see more pit boards getting ready. All of a sudden, John, what was a very great pit wall has been lit up by a bunch of colors of people's overalls.
And the leader in GT Daytona in, it's full service. Alex Ribeiras is out. New set of Continental tires as in comes Ben Keating in the 33 Viper Exchange. So that is going down towards Shea Adam and pulls to a stop.
It does, and Jerome Bleekemolen, the guy who's won here four times in the last 5 years, is ready to get behind the wheel of that. As a matter of fact, he's already climbed in because Ben Keating was eager to hand over to Jerome Bleekemolen. And let's face it, every single person up and down the paddock would be eager to co-drive with Jerome. We also have one of the bar one entrants in the pit lane. Fuel still going into the 23. The driver change and tire change has been long completed. 96 pulls into the pits as well. That is Jens Klingman, who is getting behind the wheels. Brett Curtis jumps out. We've got John Bennett, who is getting fuel only. Colin Brown will not be getting behind the wheel of that one yet. Mario is still trying to get his belts done as he drove past me on the pit lane. At least he was looking down in a manner that led me to believe so. The 20 is also in, and the 20 beats the 54 back out. A PC battle on the pit lane, as there is Nick Tandy up on the wall with his helmet. So Patrick Pile's job is now done, and Nick Tandy loves this circuit, so he will be looking forward to getting behind the wheel of the 911. The 3 is in, and I'll watch that, John.
Yeah, Nick Tandy already being bolted into the car by his teammate as the tyre and fuel ballet continues. The number 3 Corvette comes to a halt. That's a driver change as well, Shea.
It is Antonio Garcia out, and Jan Magnussen is installed in that car. 16 just rumbles past me with stickers. That's the sound of Nick Tandy leaving the pit lane. The 100 is still on the pit lane. Fueling is done. John Edwards with a really big burnout. He didn't actually go anywhere for about a second and a half because the tires were spinning and got no traction. So we're still waiting on the 25 and the 4 and the 66 and 67 from this end of pit lane in terms of the GT cars, as well as now the red of the Ricci overalls has come onto the pit wall. Tony Velander is ready to get behind the wheel of that car.
Three abreast going down into turn number 3, and Ricky Taylor in the number 10, Jordan Taylor rather, in the number 10, had to squeeze onto the grass for a moment there, but he managed to keep his third position. Joao Barbosa is leading the motor race for Action Express. Told you to watch those guys. It's 4.5 seconds now at the head of the field with Tristan Nunes in chase down mode, and he did take 0.8 seconds out of the leader last time around. Dane Cameron in third position for the second of the Action Express cars. He's hassling the back of the Mazda.
Yeah, this is really interesting, because what Action Express has chosen to do there is if they're going to have to make 3 pit stops during this race, they're assuming that in any case, and therefore they're not running the full as far as they can do on fuel. They're elected to come in, 3 laps earlier it was, during that first stint than everybody else. That means their tyres don't have to go quite as far as the other guys. They're doing 3 laps less on tyres, so they get new, fresh tyres on sooner. He's able to take advantage of that. That's one of the reasons he leapfrogged the number 555 car to move into the lead of the race. As you said there, Nunez, however, gained 0.8 seconds on that last lap. But if you look at their sector times, particularly in sector 1, every time the number 5 car is way quicker than number 55. That's because of that straight line speed advantage we talked about earlier on that the Action Express cars have. We've got this big long drag race up the start finish line to turn 1, and the other drag race from 3 to 5. Really interesting, this race.
Yeah, and we've still got this economy run at high speed going on between the 62 Ricci Competizione Ferrari. Now in the 8th position, by the way, and only 3 seconds back now, all the way from the back of the grid, the 67 of Ryan Briscoe, helped by the full course yellow, of course. The Ford GT, we know, can be extraordinarily frugal. Meantime, the number 4 Corvette is just waiting for the fuel ship. And he's down and away. That car has changed drivers as well. I saw Ollie Gavin out of that car. So this is all green flag pit stop with 1 hour and 43 minutes still to go.
Which means 2 pit stops for everybody, John.
Correct. How far can the Ferrari and the Ford go, Jeremy? And how much further do they have to go to just make it on 1 extra pit stop? Shoot, I mean, that's 1 hour and 42, 100 minutes they are at the moment. Split that in half.
They've done just over an hour.
Well, here they come now. The Ferrari is in. They should be able to go with just 1 more from here, these cars, and following him in, here comes Ryan Briscoe, just crawling up towards the back of the Ferrari on the pit lane speed limiter. Now, Shea Adam, have you chosen the Ford or the Ricci Ferrari?
I can see them both from my current position, okay, which is even better. It is a bit alarming, though, because the cars are coming at me, and they are much higher than I am. But it is Tony Wielander getting behind the wheel of the 62 as the 67 just rumbles past. Richard Westbrook is up on the pit wall for the car that won three races consecutively on the season. Tony Wielander already installed in the 62. The 88 has spun on track. I'll let you keep an eye on that, John. The tire change is already going on for the Ford. They're working on the right-hand sides. It's down, though, for the 62, waiting on fuel. Martin Bame in the 88, still waiting for him to get back underway. The 62 is underway. The 67 beats him out, though, if he can get the wheels to stop spinning. And yes, he does. The 67 beats the 62 back out. 25 still on pit lane.
Amazing turnaround from the Chip Ganassi, the Ford Chip Ganassi Racing guys, as they get out in front of the Ferrari. They came in 3 seconds behind, and here comes the 911. Round to go past both of them, right off the circuit, trying to keep out the way of the number 90 of Ryan DL. And now diving down the inside of the Tony Wielander-driven Ferrari number 62 in turn three, and he'll want to get on the tail end of that Ford as quickly as possible, whilst he's got a little bit of an advantage, and before the tyres on the Ford get up to temp and pressure. A brilliant piece of pit strategy again from the Chip Ganassi Ford team. We saw it in Canada, Jeremy. They won the race on strategy and pit work. They've won it on fuel mileage at Master Race Rio Laguna Seca. They might have to win this one on raw speed because everyone is back together again.
Yeah, they do know what they're doing, don't they? But it's a true full course yellow.
This is for Mark Kvarme, the 88 car. Right. And we can take a breath for a moment. Everybody's just pitted,
yes,
so nobody is disadvantaged. And again, I think that's decent officiating from race control. Travis Roffler, the man at the head of Continental Tires Marketing, is joining us in the booth at a very opportune moment. Good afternoon to you, sir.
Good afternoon. How are you guys doing? This is amazing already.
Yeah,
we're just getting warmed up.
Yeah, still an hour and 39 minutes to go. You were having a good time on the grid. Amazing crowd on the grid. Amazing crowd here at Road America this weekend.
The crowd at Road America never disappoints. They're an amazing group out here. We always have a good time coming here.
The Continental Tire Road Race Showcase encompasses the IMSA WeatherTech SportsCar Championship as well as the Continental Tire Series that we had so much fun with yesterday. Scott Atherton confirming the long-term inclusion of this facility on the IMSA schedule, and a facility that you've supported for some time. Something you want to be involved with again in the future?
Oh yeah, we're signed here a long-term deal too, so we'll be here for the foreseeable future back to Road America along with IMSA, so super happy. George and his whole crew here at Road America do a fantastic job. Really amazing what they've done here. Continue to improve it year after year.
Already getting some questions in for you. I'll come to you in a moment because I want to have a quick word with Patrick Peely. At least I want to let our Continental Tire pit lane reporter, Shea Adam, have a word with the man who led the GTLM field pretty much all the way to the pit stops. A little bit of argy-bargy with Giancarlo Fisichella, though, Shea.
Well, Patrick Peely, the race that you won out in Long Beach earlier in the year, you didn't get to lead a lot of laps. How good did it feel to get that Porsche back out front for a substantial amount of time?
Yeah, it's great. It's great for the complete team. You know, they did a great job. We are quite far at the beginning of the season, but we never give up. We have to thank also the IMSA because they make a great job on the BOP. It looks quite fair today. I have a great start. I know that I have to be aggressive, and I try the outside on the Ford, and it works pretty good. After the car running well, I just kill bit my front tires. That's a big issue here on this track with the carousel. And I was behind the PC, it was really slow in this part, and I just lose a lot of downforce. So that's why also the Ferrari overtake me. It was a bit, I mean, too much. I dive inside, but he didn't leave me the room outside. I mean, I can understand to push sometimes out. It was a bit too much, but anyway, it's okay. I cannot complain. They helped me with their physio, and I'm thanks for that. It's racing, it's still a long time before the end, and but the key will be clearly the tires.
Good job out there. Thanks, Patrick.
Good to hear a driver being happy about what's going on. Very close quarters racing with the Ferrari. Travis Rovler from Continental Tire is with us. Travis, we heard earlier in the weekend Scott Atherton talking about the near and medium term future of IMSA and the sport, which is changing very, very rapidly. Next year, we know we've got some new prototypes. We haven't seen them yet. Not asking you to give away any trade secrets, but clearly you've got to have tyres ready for the new DPIs and the LMP2-derived prototypes as well. How do you plan for that when we haven't seen the cars yet?
Lots of super cool, exciting news yesterday from Scott. You know, we're really excited about the whole DPI P2 format moving forward. I think everybody's excited about it. The chassis constructors are thrashing hard to get the chassis prepared, obviously, and part of that is going to be a tire to make sure that we keep those chassis on the track. So, yeah, we have a full developmental program. As always, you'd like more time, but we're given the time we're allotted when the constructors have the chassis prepared. So we're prepared with at least four, if not five, test sessions coming up in the near future with teams within the WeatherTech series in prototype. And so, you know, development's going to be underway here quickly as we get the chassis provided to us to do that testing.
How much of a start can you make in the virtual world? We hear the racing teams talking all the time about car setup and driver training, and the engineers try different things out on simulators. With a brand new car that we've not seen and we don't know the parameters for, can you at least get some idea by using CAD data and such like as to what construction and compounds you're going to have to be using on these cars?
Yes, you do. Obviously, those chassis builders like Dallara, like Leger, have already provided their force and moment data to us. So they already
force
know.
Force and moment data, I'm
correct.
Learning.
So right. we get force and moment data from them on how the chassis is going to react under certain constraints. Obviously, we know we've got to build a tire for Daytona, which is, you know, high, heavy downforce, very abusive track in what we call rovals, the ones that are on the ovals that transition on to a road course. And then tracks like Road America, believe it or not, Watkins Glen, very heavy downforce track. So we get that data from them, and then we simulate that heading into chassis development.
We got pit stops, and the leaders are in, except Tristan Nunes. The 55 Mazda has stayed out. Shea, what you got?
I have four Corvette DPs that were line of stern until they decided to all fan out at the same time. Both Action Express Corvette DPs are down. They are getting new sticker Continental tires. The 90 is in, getting new tires as well. The 10 took fuel only, so the 10 will beat everyone else back out. They go out ahead of the 90. The 5 and 31 are still stationary on the pit lane. 90 is going to jump ahead of both Action Express cars as well. We have pit stops for PC cars. Colin Brown is now behind the wheel of the 54. The 60, Oz Negri, comes straight at me. That was scary for a minute. As he goes back out, fuel and tires for that car as well. Catherine Legg behind the wheel of the Delta Wing. Kyle Marcelli is now piloting the 38 Performance Tech, a name I haven't called all year. Bruno Junqueira is behind the wheel of the 20 as Matt McMurray's day is done. And all of a sudden, what was very busy is now very quiet.
Thank you, Shea. Shea Adam is our Continental Tire Pit Lane reporter in the thick of the action. Jeremy, our IHG Rewards Club keys to the race was make cautions count. But I'm quite surprised to see all those people coming in. What have they done? Why have they done that? They still need one more pit stop before the end of the race. They're just extending their fuel window?
Yeah, no, they can get to the end from here with just one more pit stop. They needed to make two. Let's make one now under caution so we don't lose time making it under green. And isn't it interesting? The one team that didn't make that decision is number 55 car.
But I think they can go with one more stop because they own, when
no,
they
no,
stop.
No, they're going to need.
They stopped with 100 minutes to go, and I think that they can do 50 minutes and 50 minutes, surely. So that's one more pit stop. So Mazda have got the fuel mileage to go. I'll let you crunch the numbers because arithmetic was never my greatest thing. Travis Roffler is...
It was more than 8 minutes ago that we've got an hour and 32 to go now. So it was a lot more than 8 minutes ago that the number 55 car was on pit lane. That 21... which was
we're on 29 now.
Yeah, so we've done
about 10 minutes
three,
ago.
Four, five, six, seven, eight, near 15 minutes ago.
Okay, so it's going to be a bit tighter. Travis Roffler of Continental Tire is with us talking about next year. I'm intrigued to find out how all of that computer power is going into putting tyres on the cars we haven't seen yet in the virtual world. We talked a little bit about this yesterday, but it's worthwhile bringing it up again. 4 hours of Continental Tire races, both at the Rolex 24 at Daytona and at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. The fans have been asking for longer races. We deliver that. It's more work for the team, it's more work for us, but it is a format that we haven't seen in Continental Tire for a little while now. You're happy to have the longer races back?
Yeah, very excited. Those two formats obviously give those drivers, those teams, a really dynamic, different stance to go after a four-hour race like that at Daytona on a Roval, as we spoke about earlier, and then, you know, the haloed grounds of Mazda Raceway in Laguna Seca, probably the most famous sports car track in the United States, if not around the world. So very exciting for those teams. I'm sure those teams are really excited to go at it for 4 hours instead of 2 hours for the rest of the series throughout the year. So great format and two great tracks to have four-hour races at.
A question that I've asked tire representatives of all different brands down the years is, how much real technology transfer is there for what we're seeing out here in IMSA and in the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge to what is likely to go on our street cars now, tomorrow, next year? Is it way down the line, or does that product cycle come round quicker nowadays?
No, it's interesting. We obviously, from the tires themselves, these are slick tires. We have wet tires, as we don't park the cars during rain storms. We actually stay out on the track, so that's exciting. But really, there's a lot of transferred data from compounding construction and what we learn in racing and how the construction reacts under different scenarios and different force and moment data, if you will. So we learn a lot in construction and compound from what we do out here in motorsports, and that's transferred. The one thing that's exciting, we're launching a brand new tire in the spring, February of next year, called the Extreme Contact Sport. That tire was actually helped develop by five IMSA drivers that we've used in three different test sessions, trying different constructions, different compounds, and we've taken
their... A street tire.
A street tire. Street tire coming for the street in February of 17 that was basically designed and developed with the use of five of our IMSA drivers here, Oz Negri, Lawson, Andy Lally, and those folks and two others helped us to really develop that. We gave them scenarios of A, B, C, D. They went out, drove tracks like Road Atlanta, road tracks at our test facility in Uvalde,
which
Texas.
Which is unbelievable, size of a small country.
And their feedback was really put into and helped us develop what the construction was going to be, what the compound, what the tread design looks like. So really here you have really the racetrack and the input of IMSA drivers going into what will be our next UHP summer tire for the street. So really where you bring the racetrack to the street, this is really the evolution of that, if you will, over the years. This is our first introduction of a brand new summer tire into the market since we've been involved in IMSA. So this is the first iteration, will be the Extreme Contact Sport, introduced in February of next year.
Quick word about some other things that Continental are involved with. I know Continental is a huge automotive company, now probably the biggest automotive company in the world, working across all of the OEMs, not just for tires, but for all kinds of electronics, pieces of trim, rubber seals, and all that sort of thing. Also involved in other sports outside of motor racing. MLS soccer, of course, one of the big things. It's gone bonkers the last few years.
It's really,
really
crazy.
Has picked up.
It really is crazy. We've announced extension of our involvement there, so we're excited to be on board there for the ongoing future. And really, you've seen the explosion of that sport and around the country, and additions like New York Football Club and Orlando FC. We're excited. There's a team coming in Minnesota, another team out in LA. So going to 24, Dan Garber has announced that they'll take the teams to 28.
Ooh.
So getting close to that, the size of the NFL, if you imagine that ever one day in the United States for soccer, the other sport of football, if you will. So exciting news there, really good, but you know, really parts and parcel to our involvement with motorsports and endemic and the use of our product in a racetrack, and then capturing a lot of fans worldwide with the sport of soccer, one of the most popular sports around the world.
Yeah, it's been cool to see that. It's interesting, steady progression there of soccer. I was living in Columbus when the Crew Stadium was built, which is, what, I don't know, 10, 12 years ago now. And it's, you know, all these new teams coming on. It mirrors motor racing in many ways, I think.
Arthur Blank, who owns the Atlanta Falcons, founder of Home Depot, now announced Atlanta Football Club.
Oops, wait a minute.
Coming in.
Travis, thanks for being with us. Thanks for continuing to support both here at Road America and IMSA generally. Travis Ruffler, the man at the head of marketing for Continental Tire. As we go back to green with an hour and 26 minutes to go. Had hoped to be able to get some tickets for the later part of the European Championship to go and watch England play, but that didn't quite work out the way it was meant to. Great to have Travis with us. Such an enthusiast for everything that... they do. I've got to get into the rest of the business of Continental Tire because of Continental as a group. Driverless cars with Google and ABS systems and all that kind of thing. Back to green flag racing as here at trackside at roadamerica.com, live on IMSA Radio.
And that strategy of Speed Source Mazda not making a pit stop means that there's a whole string of cars between the overall leader, Tristan Nunez, and the second place car in the prototype ranks, which is actually third overall. That's the kind of a 10 now as a result of that round of pit stops. Jordan Taylor got out ahead of Ryan Diel and Joao Barbosa and Dane Cameron. So that's a big shuffle around there. But he's got a huge clear track. And those other prototypes, they're going to work their way past all the GTLM cars. So they're going to lose time doing that. Yeah, this is going to give, what I'm saying is, it's going to give a great opportunity here for Tristan Nunez to go bye-bye from the rest of the field.
Yeah, I'm going to remotely pilot our Continental Tire pit lane reporter, Shea Adam, down to Mazda and to the Mazda Sport team, to find out what their fuel strategy is and how close they are, if at all, to being able to go on just one more stop. ISG Rewards Club, keys to the race. You've got to get your fuel numbers to add up. They may just need a very small splash, though. And that could take them out of contention here. So that is the question to ask those guys. It's Tristan Nunez is down to the 157s immediately as soon as he was released on the green flag. Shea Adam?
Well, on the radio, they are telling Tristan to push as hard as he can to try and put as much distance between he and the guys who are in traffic right now. That does not sound like fuel-saving strategy. And if they have told Tristan that he's going to be doing this on one more stop, they certainly would not have told him to push like bleep.
Okay, understand that. Contact between the Daytona prototype of Action Express, I think it was Dane Cameron, got sideswiped by one of the GT cars that he was going by, one of the gaggle of GT cars, and we've got three wide, GTLM, PC, and the prototype cars coming down towards turn number five. This is an absolute recipe for disaster if everyone doesn't keep their wits about them, but somehow they do. Coming through turn one was where the contact happened just a few moments ago, and that is exactly what Jeremy Shaw was saying about the advantage that Tristan Nunez has to build up whilst these guys are dealing with cars that are battling the GTLM category, which is led at the moment, by the way, by the 67 Ford of Richard Westbrook. Nick Tandy is right on his tail. Those two know each other very well indeed. Tony Wielander third in the 62 Ferrari from Fred Macko in the 9-1-2. It actually just saved Frederick Macko on our time. Diving and scoring there as well in fourth position. Then it's Jan Magnussen in the 3 Corvette. The BMW number 100 is John Edwards on board. Tommy Milner now behind the wheel of the number 4. And Dirk Werner in 8th position in GTLM. But they are separated by less than 10 seconds from first to last in the GTLM category. And that's with prototype traffic coming through them, Jeremy.
Yeah, this is wild stuff down there, and the guy who lost out in all of that was Joao Barbosa. They remember that car, number 5 car, was leading before this caution period pretty comfortably over the Mazda, and it's now way back in the overall order. He's got some work to do. There's that battle going towards turn one now. Third and fourth, 90 to 31 car, the number 5, and Ozzie Negri is right there as well.
Yeah, the number five of Joao Barbosa staying out of that fight for the moment, but it won't be long before Joao is in amongst it, I would fear, as he has to just squeeze the 911 Porsche of Nick Tandy second at the moment. No, check that. The 911 is ahead of... No, he's ahead of Wielander, but Westbrook's up the road. That's all right. Richard Westbrook still leads for Ford. I saw a red rear end behind Tandy. That red back end of the car was a Ferrari, not a Ford. A distinctive
GTD battle as well. That's huge, isn't it? Got the Viper now. He's leapfrogged ahead. Jerem Blekemolen leads that class. Those two Stevenson Audis running once again in second and third. They've maintained second and third. The number 23 car has fallen way, way back down the order. But they've been leapfrogged by the Viper, which now leads away. Jörg Bergmeister there in fourth place as well. Then Alessandro Balzan in the Ferrari.
Ryan DL has broken clear of the gaggle of traffic, as has Jordan Taylor. So Tristan Nunez now with 20.6 seconds on the chasing hordes of Chevy Corvette Daytona prototypes. 10, 90, 31 and 5, with Oz Negri Jr. just hanging on to the tail end of that battle. He could be the joker in the pack here. That LMP2 car, very, very quick indeed, but he has got those four Chevy Corvette prototypes to try and get by. He can see them, Jeremy, but I'm not sure what he can do about them. Will he have the speed down the straights?
1 minute 56.16 on that lap, by the way, by Tristan Nunez. Oh. He has got that hammer down. He's doing exactly what he was told to do.
Yes, he's bleeping along very nicely, in fact. An hour and 20 minutes to go. We're live trackside at Road America as another clutch of cars steam through in front of us. Blue flags being waved all around the circuit for drivers to let drivers know they've got traffic behind them. Third, fourth, fifth and sixth almost together as they head down towards turn five. Flash of the headlight from Dane Cameron to Ryan DL. Ryan DL will completely ignore that. Moves to the middle of the road. Cameron to the inside at turn five. Can he get the car stopped on the exit? He can. There's been a lot of very bold manoeuvres down at turn five. Majority of them have come off. Fisichella had a couple that were not quite as successful before he made one that did. Somebody's throwing fluid out on the circuit as well, because the windscreen of Ryan DL is very badly marked up with streaks, and we haven't had any kind of rain or precipitation here, so something is getting sprayed up from the back of a car that he's been following. His windscreen wiper sits straight up on the number 90 car, and it moves around about a 30 degree arc, and I think he's having trouble seeing in certain parts of the circuit, as he is now struggling to hold on to his fourth position as the João Barbosa driven Action Express number five is all over the back of it. And here comes João Barbosa in the Honda powered Ligier of Michael Shank Racing, the chrome bronze car, and he's got all kinds of rubbish on his screen as well. That's very interesting. So there is certainly somebody out there who's been spraying up some kind of liquid. Looks like he may have had a wipe on the screen to get rid of some of it. He might have even wiped it with his windscreen wiper, because there's a little bit better view lower down on the windshield from the 60 car. 33, Jerome Blekemolen leads GT Daytona for Dodge Viper. They've always had a good record here. But behind him, Robin Liddell in the number six Audi. His teammates behind him, then Jörg Bergmeister. The top four absolutely together. Alessandro Balzan is another 1.3 seconds further back in the Ferrari. That's a good run for them as the Ford comes through. And behind Alessandro is Jens Klingmann in the 96 Turner BMW. So top six in GT Daytona together as the 66 Ford, the car that was delayed earlier on with the suspension problem in the early laps. Joey Hand now behind the wheel, taking over from Dirk Muller, and he's picking his way through this top. He's not that much quicker than the GTD cars. Drags past the second of the Audis, the 9 car. And down into turn five, should have a little bit of advantage on the brakes, but it's not much. And clearly wasn't pleased with the driver of the nine car as he just squeezed across him a little bit, but they're in a battle. And Joey's many laps down.
New lap record here.
55.6
by Tristan Nunez.
Called it before it happened. Jeremy, have you got the lottery numbers as well for me?
He was a gnat's whisker away from the lap record last time, so I was watching specifically for that. I mean, this is a really cool strategy by the Speedsport Mazda team. They're absolutely flying, and they're certainly going to have to make two more pit stops to everybody else's one, probably, but it's still going to be really interesting. This race is not over by any means.
By the way, thanks for your questions for Travis Roffler. We will pass them on. Didn't get a chance because we went back green to ask some of the questions that came through. But I promise we'll pass them on to the Continental Tire team and get you some answers back. Some very good ones there as well. But the headline there, IMSA race drivers developed a new tire for Continental, launched next February. Track to street technology, it's absolute basics. Blind testing, take the tyres out, tell me which one you like best and why. And we'll incorporate those facilities into the next set of Continental Street tyres. This from the race organisers. Thanks, Nate Siebens, for dropping by with this. The 23 Alex Job Racing car will have a stop plus 60 seconds hold for running the red light at the pit exit. That is pretty basic stuff.
Once again, the number 23 car, they qualified on pole four times this season, and they keep on shooting themselves in the foot with all sorts of problems, you know, either throwing the car off the track or making a mistake or whatever it is. It's going to be frustrating.
In the pit lane now, GTT battle. Absolutely extraordinary at the moment with the 33 Viper and Jerome Blegemolen holding on to the lead. He's just done his fastest lap of the race, 208.5. That's not hanging about. And he's quick enough that the Joey hand-driven Ford, he's not able to just blow by. Where these cars make their time around the track and their lap times, Jeremy, you'd think it would be there's a decent spread of lap times, but it's not that easy for the GTLM cars to just, they're not blowing by these GTD cars. GTDs are pretty slippery.
Oh, very much so. Yes, they are, and particularly the Lamborghinis. They are the quickest of all in the GTD. But what a battle this is amongst the GTD contenders. By the way, a new fastest lap, a new lap record for Tristan Nunez. What a great sit this has been. His last four laps, 56.16, 55.75, 55.62, 55.45 as the fuel load is burning down. Brilliant job by him, and again, it shows the durability of these Continental tyres because they're just going faster and faster and faster. Very cool. Good battle, by the way, also in PC, just not so those guys don't get left out. Tom Kimber-Smith has moved to the front there. Steve Simpson, though, has tracked him down. Those two have just set their best laps of the race so far, and also right in contention. Two of the Starworks cars, Jose Gutierrez and Renger van der Zande. Colin Brown is riding there. Cool stuff.
55.458 for Nunez. Now, he was last in on lap 21. And I reckon he's got about another 15 minutes, Jeremy.
Who's so that? The race
Nunez?
Leader?
Yeah? If that?
Yeah, if that.
Let's go down to Mark Goossens, who is out of the number 90 car. Ryan DL in fifth position at the moment and battling with João Barbosa for fourth, Shane.
Mark, you look quite warm from that stint. We're seeing visibility issues from the onboard car of a lot of not only the DP but the P2 cars. Was that an issue for you when you were out there?
Well, it wasn't too bad early on in the race, but yeah, towards the end of my stint, I saw a couple of stains on the windshield too. So I don't know if some cars were losing oil or where it came from, but you know, it covered it up. You know, all of a sudden, I didn't see that coming, but. Right now, that's not our biggest issue. I think we're fighting for pace. So, you know, Ryan is in P4 right now, so hopefully we can hang on to it.
Did the car feel better to you in the race than it had all weekend?
Yeah, already this morning in the warm-up, we felt a little bit more comfortable with the car. And, you know, we're just trying to make the best out of it. And biggest problem is the car gets loose after a number of laps. So trying to look after the tires and see what we got towards the end.
Championship. Adam with a Continental tyre pit lane update with Dade Cameron. With Mark Goossens. I was looking at the timing screen. Joao Barbosa has just put in the fastest first sector of the race. He's 4 seconds away from a podium position at the moment behind Dade Cameron. That was the point I was about to get to. Joao Barbosa in the number 5 Action Express Corvette, then chasing down the top three. Jordan Taylor, 25 seconds behind. That is a gap that's going out, not coming down at the head of the field, and that is down to the extraordinary pace of the Mazda. Mazda Racing doing a cracking job over the last few races. Do they believe that they can win? Can they make this happen? Can they get that tick in the W column? Tristan Nunes is into the pit lane right now with 1 hour and 11 minutes to go. Now, that is too far. Jeremy, you were right. Sorry about that. I did the wrong maths. Fuel numbers have got to add up because one lap short here, you will not get back to the pit lane. IHG Rewards Club keys to the race for Mazda. Now, this has to be a faultless stop, as we saw earlier on. Shea Adam is down with the Mazda team.
Four Continental tires up on the pit wall as they go to work. Left front, right rear as fuel is going in. Tristan Nunez not getting out of this car. I don't think they could, even if they wanted to, get him out. Now they are going right front, left rear. They're having a bit of an issue with the left rear. It rolled away from the mechanic. No problem, fuel still going in. Left rear tire not yet on. No panic, everyone stayed calm. And I think Tristan put a lot of heat into those rear tires as he was leaving.
I think you're absolutely right. And once again, that was done just as the fuel came out. So that's as good a stop as those guys could do with the fuel rate, fuel flow, and the tank size that they've got. And Nunes back in, will join back in down in sixth position. And he's going to be half a minute or so behind the guys who have gone through. But everybody now needing one more stop to the end. It's just that the Mazda will need a considerably shorter stop to the end. Check that, he's dropped down to eighth position as a couple of PC cars have gone through as well. So, what Mazda want now is this race to go green right the way through. And then hopefully they'll take a splash somewhere near the end. They can't be that far away. What do we reckon, Jeremy? 15 minutes?
Yeah, 15 minutes or so, yeah.
Yeah. So leading now is Jordan Taylor from Dane Cameron, who is absolutely charging. Cameron, a 56 flat last time around, is the fastest lap for that car of the race. Joao Barbosa, a 55.7. Top three, by the way, now, separated by just 5 seconds or so, with Oz Negri Jr. still in the hunt as well. 56.7 for him. Lot of very light colours on our timing screen, which means people are doing their best laps of the race.
Yeah, and the guy's really struggling now is Ryan Dayal. I mean, he got passed by Joao Barbosa just a couple of laps ago, and then also by number 60 car of Oz Negri, so he's really dropping back.
The battle in GTD is still, frankly, quite awesome, with just a second between first and second, then half a second, a second. Half a second and a tenth in the top seven. No positional changes there, though, with Jerome Bleeker-Morland still leading from Robin Liddell in second place. Then his teammate in third. Then it's Jörg Bergmeister, Alessandro Palzan
and
in the 63.
Jens Klingman and Andy Lamb,
yes,
as well.
That's the top.
All in a train.
Yes, that's the top seven who are all in a train, separated by, let's work this out, about 4.5 seconds.
Yeah, if that.
Into the pit lane, but Dirk Werner, the number 25 BMW from the GT11 fight, which is, by the way, just as exciting with the top five there within 4.5 seconds. So yeah, the 25 BMW in.
And interesting, yeah, that's interesting that car's the first one to come into pit lane. Shouldn't need a pit stop right now. It was in on lap 26. But an hour and 7 minutes to go. Ooh.
It's tight.
They'll be pushing it to do it from there. But they're hedging their bets. If there's a full course caution, they're quids in with that car. I'm so intrigued by PC because we've got the leader there is still Tom Kimmersmith and Stephen Simpson. They're pulling away a little bit from Jose Gutierrez, who is also not really under pressure now from either Renger van der Zander or Colin Brown, who acknowledged as the two aces in PC. They're making no ground on those three cars ahead of them at this stage anyhow.
Robert Alon, it's been a great season for you so far coming into this race. Now the points championship is really intensifying, but you're sitting second. You and Tom Kimmersmith still want to go for another win. Do you think that the car today can get you back there?
Yeah, I think we have a good car today and making some good, putting some good times down. And I think we got it in us today.
Tom's in the car now. He'll be in for the remainder of the race. What is he saying on the radio about how the car is performing?
I mean, I haven't heard much, but I mean, looking at the lap times, it seems like he's enjoying the car a bit. Just set the fastest lap, so.
Keep an eye on Tom Kimmersmith, three-time Le Mans winner, and he knows how to win at Road America.
Thank you, Shea Adam. And, thank you to Sarah, to Sandra from Marion's, who's just popped up to get us through to the end of the race with a bit of light refreshment. Gelato has arrived.
Life is good.
Jordan Taylor by 7/10 of a second at the head of the field. Dane Cameron continues to close him down. It's been a very good run by Dane Cameron in GTLM. Richard Westbrook has Nick Tandy and Tony Wielander and Fred Macko in his wheel tracks. Top four separated by just 3 seconds. This is a proper old-fashioned battle here. They need about five more minutes before their last pit stops. But we know that the Ferrari and the Ford can go a bit longer than the Porsches and the BMWs and the Corvettes. So they get the advantage of a little more thinking time, Jeremy. And they don't have to jump straight away. An hour and five.
Yeah, so Dane Cameron's caught Jordan Taylor. Now, can he get past him? That's going to be the interesting thing. I think the number 31 car has a little bit more straight line speed, but is he going to be able to get himself into a place where he can take advantage of that? And those two, they've now pulled themselves 5 seconds away from Joao Barbosa, who clearly had quite a bit of traffic on that lap. It cost him more than a couple of seconds. But, God, this is a fantastic motor race, it really is. Ozzie Negri, he's just turning some personal best sectors as well in car number 60, running in the fourth position.
Just brilliant battles all the way through the field at the moment. The GT categories looking really strong. And let's not forget our next IMSA broadcast here on the RSL networks and IMSA radio and the IMSA app will be from VIR, which is a GT festival. No prototypes at all. GTLM and GTD in the parkland of VIR. Right on the ragged edge, all of these drivers. Nick Tandy has not had a season up to his very high standards so far. But he's got the sniff of not just a podium, but a victory here. Meantime, at the head of the field, Jordan Taylor and Dane Cameron are together and they have traffic. Ahead of them is that battle. They're right in the middle of the GTT battle. Balzan in fifth position steers to drivers left down towards Canada Corner as the two leading prototypes come through. And now they've got ahead of them Jörg Bergmeister in the 73 Porsche, then the two Audis, then Jerome Blakemolen. And they've all got to be passed nice and cleanly. Dane Cameron was for a moment right up on the tail end of the leader, but had to give room to Jörg Bergmeister, which he did, very sporty, didn't squeeze the GT Daytona car on the final corner. Now, into turn one, past one of the Audis, past both of the Audis, down into turn one. Jordan Taylor, Dane Cameron have Jerome Blakemolen. Now, Blakemolen will not want to lose time here, so they'll have to be smooth down towards turn number three. And the leader goes through. Oh, and the leader's gone wide. And there goes the Dane Cameron car. And Gorsen sweeps through into the lead. And that was just a little bit of impatience there by Jordan Taylor. We did say patience, and don't forget the guys there were battling through the lead battle in GTLM. And Jordan Taylor just went a little bit deep into turn three, trying to get the pass made. Looked like he had position on Bleekemolen. Well, yes, he did, but then couldn't get the car stopped. And the old over and under move by Dane Cameron was a masterful reading of the traffic. You know, sometimes, Jeremy, you've got to plan ahead. He saw that situation unfolding, and like chess, he was two steps ahead in his mind, already making the move before he turned into the corner.
Yeah, that really was brilliant driving by Dane Cameron. He read that situation absolutely perfectly and took advantage of it. He's got the quickest car amongst the DP cars out there. This is running at front at the moment, and that was a really, really good pass. I mean, Jordan Taylor is a pretty heads-up driver in his own right, so to outsmart him, which is effectively what he did in that corner, was absolutely magnificent. And he's now flying along there, and Joao Barbosa, they've all had to work their way through that traffic, and Joao Barbosa, having lost the ground a couple of laps ago, has made really, really good progress on that last lap to get closer again to the two leaders. So we've got a great battle going on here now.
Top three are separated by less than 2 seconds as they go past us, Jeremy, but now it's the 31 Action Express Corvette prototype from the 10 Wayne Taylor Racing car, and the 5, the second of the Action Express cars. Oz Negri has dropped back a bit through that traffic, often the case with the LMP2 derived cars, to try and keep their momentum up a little bit. Oh, and another little mistake, tiny mistake from Jordan Taylor. He goes off the track at turn three, drops a left rear wheel into the dirt, and we've seen that have consequences all weekend here. And will it be one now as Joao Barbosa and Jordan Taylor cross the timing line almost together at the end of sector one going into sector two? Barbosa having a look.
Nice
through
try.
Five. Yeah, got to have a go.
Yes.
Got to have a go. So let's give you, whilst we have a moment, a rundown with an hour to go of what is going on in the classes. Jerome Bleekemolen by 0.7 seconds over Robin Liddell. 33 from 6 from 9 from Jörg Bergmeister in the 73, from Alessandro Balzan in the 63 Ferrari. And then Andy Lally in the Audi number 44, and Jens Klingmann in the 96 BMW. And they are separated by, I can work out the arithmetic at the moment, about 4.5, 5 seconds. And that's the top 7 in GTD. And GTLM, just as tight, really. Richard Westbrook for Ford has pulled out almost 3 seconds over Nick Tandy, who has got 1.3 over Tony Wielander. So Ford 67, Porsche 911, Ferrari 62, Porsche 912, just 0.7 seconds now, behind.
And BMW number 100, John Edwards is right there.
Yes,
and
he's
then,
pulled back.
And then the two Corvettes. Now, what's interesting about that is they've slipped back from that battle. They're now 7 seconds behind, but number 4 car, Tommy Milner, has got past Jan Magnussen and pulled away really rapidly over the last... Well, in the last 5 laps, he pulled out over 3 seconds over Jan Magnussen. So once again, Tommy Milner really doing showing a good turn of speed there.
In the PC battle, 7th overall is their leader. It's Tom Kimber-Smith in the number 52 car. He's got 1.5 seconds from Stephen Simpson in the bright yellow JDC 85. Jose Gutierrez is another 4.5 seconds further back in 3rd in the 7 with his Starworks teammate Renger van der Zander. Able to make a huge inroads into the leaders there. And then it's Colin Brown into the pits. Comes the number 77 Porsche, Gunnar Jeanette from 12th position. New set of Continentals going on. Gunnar opens the door. Can I get out yet? No, I'm going to stay in. Keep driving. All right. Fairness, I don't think Gunnar Jeanette ever asked to get out of a car.
Lap time by Dane Cameron, 56.1 is another good lap by Dane Cameron. Pulled out a little bit now over Jordan Taylor, who's battling to hold off the second of the Action Express cars. And this was a season last year that proved the springboard toward the championship for the number 31 car. They didn't ultimately get it, and that was really as a result of the timing of the ending of the Petit Le Mans race, because they could have easily won the championship there. They were in the they were in command of the championship until the final round of pit stops, and then the end of that race came along.
Gunnar Chenet, then that's his last pit stop, isn't it, in that 77? So that's the first of the final pit stops of the GTLM cars. Dean Cameron setting light to the racetrack at the moment. 33.6 in the first sector is brilliant. Meantime in GTLM, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, down at turn five, Ferrari, Porsche, BMW. Tommy Milner not too far off the back of those guys now. Closing on them about 7 seconds behind, but he is gaining. And if these three trip up, then that will be valuable points in the championship for Corvette. Number 100, BMW, remember, along with its teammate, starting at the back of the grid. Yes, there was some help with full course yellow. Richard Westbrook, often thought and categorised as a few years ago as a one-trick pony, just a Porsche driver, just a GT driver. Well, he's proved his critics wrong in both prototypes and now with Ford in GT. And not only has he won a race earlier this season by his amazingly light right foot with fuel mileage to die for in the EcoBoost Ford GT, now he's winning a race on pure pace, staying ahead of Nick Tandy by 4 seconds, 67 from 911. Then the battle coming up to the start-finish line now with Tony Wielander, Fred Macko and John Edwards. John Edwards has got a nice run here behind the Porsche of Fred Macko, who goes to the inside early. Can't move back now. Oh, Fred, be careful. Went to the right-hand side to cover the inside move. John Edwards tried to go back to the outside, but Fred moved back onto the racing line. Now, I think he'll be all right with it so long as there's no overlap. But you can't be making multiple moves and reacting to the car alongside or behind you, and the BMW is going through. Now, into the braking area for turn five. Who has got the most on the brakes? And it's the BMW, just that gets round the outside and immediately cuts in front of the 912 of Fred Macko. I think that just underlines what we were commenting on coming down in towards turn number one. Just to say, wasn't too happy about you pulling across in front of me in a turn one, rather. But that is another place made up by John Edwards, now fourth position. And I am not counting at all against that BMW going further up the field. The 100 looks a good package this weekend. Into the pit lane for the GTD leader, Shea Adam is there.
Jerome Bleekemolen brings the car on the pit lane speed limiter, which is about halfway down the pit lane is where the Riley Motorsports box is. They are giving Jerome Bleekemolen some new Continental rubber on his car, changing the left front tire. They're doing the same tire change strategy that we see employed in Mazda in today's race. They have finished the tire change. Fuel's still going into that very thirsty V10 as the 7 has now pulled into the pits as well. Gustavo Yakimin will be getting behind the wheel of that. Jose Gutierrez jumps out. Yakimin, another name I haven't called yet this year, as fuel's still going into the 33 Viper. Now Jerome Bleekemolen gets away. We also have the 23 on the pit lane a bit further down, but after the penalty today, they really are not in as much contention as Jerome Bleekemolen. We see guys up on the wall for the 63. Scuderi, of course, will be coming in soon. Balzac will be staying behind the wheel of that, as well as the 22 is coming down the pit lane now. Sven Müller is behind the wheel, and there were new tires on that car as well, but the 911 guys are up on the pit wall ready for their driver to come in. The 67 crew is not. They will not be pitting in any time soon before the 911.
Well, no, we saw that, didn't we, Shea? Thank you. In the first set of pit stops, the Ford and the Ferrari went four or five laps further into the race. There, no suggestion that they'll do anything different. Joao Barbosa has been caught, has got by rather, Jordan Taylor, and pulled away by about a second. So it's the two Action Express teammates now, 31 and 5, who are controlling the front of the race. Jordan Taylor has 9 seconds on Oz Negri, who has 12 on Ryan Diel, who has 10 on Tristan Nunez, who's not been able to lap anywhere near as quickly since he came out of the pits. Now, I've just seen a Mazda Racing tweet that says Tristan Nunez P6 charging, still on a fuel strategy of our own, which equals more options, but we need to close the gap. GTD pit stops now. Two Audis into the pit lane here.
Three Audis, technically. The two of the six and the nine have already stopped in their box. There is tires for both of those cars prepared and going on. The 44 also stops in its box. Number six on the side of Andy Lally's Audi. There are four new Continental tires for that car as well. 63 getting four tires and fuel. That Ferrari is up on its high stance. The bright red is the last car on pit lane, so it should be the first one off. Fuel going into that car. Tires are stickers on the Ferrari. Andy Lally is down, just waiting on fuel. The six is the first car back out, closely followed by the nine. Jürg Burgmeister in the number 73 is third behind them, then goes out the 63. The 96 rolls by me as well, the BMW, and now Andy Lally leaves the pit lane in the Audi. I have the 80 coming at me of the Viper. Dan Knox started that car. It's Mike Skeen behind the wheel, as it has been for the last few laps. And I now have a Corvette. Is that? That's Tommy Vilner behind the wheel of the number four. And I'll keep you posted on that stop.
Thank you, Shea. Battles out on the racetrack as well with a 33. Making a position, getting back past the Audi.
What happened there, John, was that the 33 car came in one lap earlier than all the other GTD leaders came in that one lap after that. But Jerome Blakeman has retained the lead after that round of pit stops just from the number six car. So great that battle will continue there. That was something else I was going to talk about as well. I can't remember what it was now. Another four Corvette was in the pits, yeah, so the first of the GTD. My point is now, they can all get to the end of the race from here. It's going to be interesting to see when the GTLM cars elect to come onto pit lane.
Shea was watching that stop for the number four Corvette. Looked pretty quick. Did they take four tyres?
Yes, they did. That's Corvette Racing pit stop for you. Those guys are the best in the biz.
And the number 62 Ferrari making up a position a moment or two ago and going to the lead ahead of Nick Tandy. He must have given it back the next corner. Yes, he did. Going to second place ahead of Nick Tandy. Richard Westbrook is still leading the GTLM battle for Ford, of course. And Nick Tandy is in the pit lane. Nick Tandy in the pit lane then from seventh. He battled back from second. He battled back to that. Wielander then will take over second position. Nick Tandy in the number 100 BMW into the pit lane as well. These will be the final stops for these GTLM cars. And this Continental Tire pit lane report comes to you with Jay Adam.
Nick Tandy comes to a stop perfectly on his marks as the 48 rumbles past me. That was a tire and fuel stop only for them. Tire change already going on for Nick Tandy and the number 100. No driver change on either of those, not that you'd expect. The Porsche with a much quicker tire change than the BMW. Fuel still waiting for the number 911. That is the only thing holding them in the pit lane. Car is down off of its air jacks. Same thing now for the number 100. The 100 actually gets done fueling first, but can't get the grip. And the 911 beats it back out. So the 911 narrowly ahead of the number 100.
Thank you, Shea. Shea Adam down in the pit lane as we're inside the last 50 minutes of what has been a stunning motor race. It's all Scott Atherton's fault. He promised us the best 2 hours and 40 minutes that we'd ever seen at the start of this, and it's delivered. He clearly got the script right. There's a bit of extra budget this weekend, and the surroundings, the setting couldn't be any better. Road America at this time of the year with the green of the trees and the grass. Been a lot of camping this weekend, although I notice a lot of people are ready to hit the road at the end of this, particularly down at the motorplex. The camping tents have come down, but the cars are all still there. It's going to be another little Grand Prix getting out of here. And as yet, Jeremy Shaw, we're not calling any of these classes because it's just too close to call.
It absolutely is, and interesting, isn't it? Number 67 car stays out there. Richard Westbrook, once again, getting great fuel mileage and good pace in that Ford Chip Ganassi Racing 4 GT. And here's the other leaders in now in GTLM coming to pit lane. Number 62 car and a number 912 Porsche.
Richard
and
Westbrook, though, still out there, Jeremy. So that Ford's
indeed,
still getting good fuel mileage.
That's my point. And if there's a full course caution on this lap, the Ganassi racer will regret it.
Well, that's interesting because the Ford and the Ferrari were both in on lap 26, the last stop. Shea, what have you got for us in the pit lane?
Fuel and tires for both cars. The 62 has finished changing the boots on their car. The car is lowered down. They are waiting on fuel for the 62. Now the tire change is done for the 912. 62 is out. They beat the 912 by a substantial margin. Fred McAvecky still on the pit lane. Now it gets the car into gear and manages to find some traction. The 67's pit board is out. They will be in next lap.
Thank you, Shea. And that is last pit stops for those guys as well. Live from trackside at Road America, IMSA Radio, talking to the world, as well as all of you here on 454, the biggest endurance racing community pulled together with no interruptions from lights to flag here. And this one has been enthralling for the whole hour and 55 that we've had so far. The PC battle has been broken up by pit stops as well. Tom Kimber-Smith cycles back to the front of that from Wrenger van der Zande by 4 seconds, 5 seconds at the moment, but they have only made two pit stops to everyone around them, three. So now in the pit lane is the 31 of Dane Cameron. João Barbosa still leading by 1.4 seconds to Jordan Taylor then. In comes the unmistakable sound of a V8 on the pit lane speed limiter, and he is followed in, notably, by the Ford. So that is the GTLM leader, Richard Westbrook. What are you watching, Shea?
Oh, I'm ready for this. Dane Cameron pulls to a stop. They have the left side Continental tires already being changed on that car. Fuel going in as the 67 makes its way to its box, comes to a stop as well. They are having a bit of a slow stop on the left rear for the number 31. Now they've gotten that complete. Move over to change the right-hand side tires for Dane Cameron. The 90s pit board is also dangling. I look back and I see that car as well as the 60. Michael Schenck Racing also on pit lane. The 60 has finished the tire change. They have finished the fueling and the 60 goes back out. 31, though, is already long gone. 67 is now leaving the pit lane as the 90 comes to a stop perfectly on its marks as well. Razzle Dazzle staying behind the wheel for the final stint, and he's getting some stickers. They are putting lots of fuel in that number 90, as now the 52's pit board is starting to wave as well. Tom Kimber-Smith coming down the pit lane, being followed not very closely, but still in tail, is Wrenger van der Zande. That's the sound of Razzle Dazzle going back out as Tom Kimber-Smith comes in and hits his marks. His pit box about 100 feet up from Wrenger van der Zande. So he is getting his new tires put on, stickers as well. And Wrenger van der Zande will be getting 4 new Continental tires and a whole lot of fuel.
Gotta find out when the number 5 of João Barbosa and the 10 of Jordan Taylor are going to come in. They've been out there since lap 29. We're on 52 now, and at that point Tristan Nunes will be back in the lead of the motor race. And indeed, as the thought goes through my head and leaves through my mouth, here are the two leaders, first and second, back down to the Continental Tire pit lane reporter.
The pit board dangling for the Konica Minolta number 10. Black pit board matches the car identically, the 5 all the way down. They have the last pit box. João Barbosa rumbling past Jordan Taylor pulling to a stop. He comes to his pit box slightly before Zhuo. New Continental tires for both of these cars. Eight sets of stickers between the two of them. Lots of fuel going in. These guys will want to make sure they have enough for every lap plus one, because no one wants to replicate what we had in yesterday's race. Both cars down off their air jacks. Both cars waiting on fuel. Fuel out for the 10. The front right wheel on the 5 is an issue. That slowed them down, but they still beat the 10 car back out. The gap they came in with is pretty much the gap they left with.
That would have been a much quicker stop for Action Express. We said in our ISG Rewards Club keys to the race, seconds count in the pit stops, and there was just a little jam on the right front. The mechanic couldn't quite get the last bit of tightening as it went down. I think it may have just either cross-threaded or pulled the air wrench out of his hands, and they've dropped in behind Dane Cameron. So Cameron in second now is 30 seconds, check that, 27 seconds behind Tristan Nunes. What's a drive down the pit lane here?
About 40 seconds. Here, yeah.
Yeah. So Nunes can't even splash now without giving up the weight and the lead. So I reckon if that's the case, only Mazda Racing know how close they are, but I reckon you bring him in now whilst he's got 26 seconds and then set him on stun. He's going to come out in fourth position, just ahead of Osnegri Jr.
Yeah, but overtaking is really difficult. We've seen that in the past. They don't have the straight line speed here that the other contenders do. So you really, if he can, he needs to build that advantage.
If he can. 57.9 last time around. We know that car's capable of mid-55s, but traffic is an issue through the race. So Tristan Nunes is leading again for Mazda Racing. Dane Cameron then waiting to come through in second place. Then it's Barboza and Jordan Taylor at the wheel of the 5 and 10, respectively. The battles in PC and GTLM continue. It's 5 seconds now at the head of the field for Richard Westbrook, ahead of Tony Wielander in second in the number 62. So Ford 67, Ferrari 62, two Porsches, 911 and 912, separated by about 10 seconds. So that, after the pit stops, that really interesting GTLM battle has broken up a little bit. The GTDs, however, haven't. Bleekemolen and Liddell, first and second, 0.7 seconds. And the 0.7 seconds, then the third place, number 9, Audi, is just another half a second back. They've got a second on York Bergmeister in the 73 Porsche, the dark grey car with the red accents. 26 comes into the pit lane. Johnny Morlam getting out of that car from 8th position in PC. So almost 30 seconds the lead now for Tristan Nunes, as Dane Cameron was caught up in traffic there, and it did a 2:0.085 against a 58.4. So Nunes now has to try and make hay in the sunshine here in Wisconsin. Inside the last 40 minutes, 2 hours have been completed. We're live on IMSA Radio from trackside here at Road America. Jeremy Shaw, Shea Adam, and me, John Hindhoff. Take a breath while you can, because it is quite possible that the last 40 minutes will be just like the first 40 and pretty breathless. So the 67 Ford of Richard Westbrook leads in GTLM. Dave Cameron is in second in the 31. His teammate Joao Barboza is 2 seconds behind him, a little less than that, I would say, just from eye. They're coming across the line now. We'll find out in a moment. There goes the 31 red and white car. He's about 2 seconds. Take that back. In fact, it's a little more, 2.4. Jordan Taylor, another 1.9 further back. Lapping similar lap times, but Tristan Nunes at the moment taking time out of the Chevy prototype behind him and taking time out at a second plus a lap, Jeremy. And he's got to find in the next 15 minutes or so, I reckon, So that's 7.5-8 laps. He's probably got to find 10 or 12 seconds if he's going to come out in the lead after his splash of fuel. It's a tall order. Basically asking for more than a second a lap until he comes into the pit lane. He's on qualifying duty now, isn't he? That's what they've got to set him on.
Yeah, absolutely right, and it's a good lap last time around there. It was, wasn't it? But he's got an awful lot of ground to have to make up. I don't know whether he can do it. It's a Corvette battle, by the way. We've got number four car now in the sixth place in the class. That's the championship leader coming into this weekend in GTLM. Just earned his best lap of the race is Tommy Milner. In the PC, meanwhile, it's still Tom Kimber-Smith who leads. After that final round of pit stops, Renger van der Zander had jumped up into second place. And coming past us now is this battle for third with
pit lane action, Jeremy, because in has come Tristan Nunes. So they're giving him something in the region of 35 minutes to get back past the cars he's going to sit behind when he comes out after this splash of fuel. No doubt Dan Cameron will come through. He's coming up the start-finish lane straight now, and he hasn't. I don't think the Mazda's even stopped yet. Yes, it has. Shea is there.
Tristan Nunes perfectly hits his marks. The fuel man put the fueling in, wasting no time before they had even started changing tires, because that is the thing that matters the most. Do you have enough fuel to make it through? We've already had Dayton Cameron cross the start-finish line. Tires are done. Fueling is done. They've matched up perfectly. Tristan Nunes now twice does massive burnouts as he leaves the pit lane. After I said earlier, he was so nice to cars.
It's interesting. They put quite a lot of fuel in that car, so he'll set that to full rich now, and he's going to drop down. Has Osnegri gone through? Yes, he has. He's going to drop down behind Osnegri. Where's Ryan Dalziel? Not yet come through. And Nunes has battling GT Daytona cars right in front of him in the shape of Audi number 44 and BMW number 96. That's Andy Lally and Jens Klingman. Needs to clear those guys pretty quickly, coming down the hill towards turn five, and he will be able to pull out the drivers left and do that. So Tristan Nunes has 35 minutes now to make up something in the region of 40 seconds on the leader. But he's done, he's fueled to the end. No more scheduled pit stops for the top six cars. And the battle for the lead intensifies with Tom Kimber-Smith in seventh in the 52, leading the prototype challenge. He's got 4 seconds of an advantage, fueled to the end, and under 2 minutes for his lap time last time around, and that was matched by Renger van der Zander in second place. It's beginning to heat up again.
And behind them, Bruno Junqueira has just been overtaken by Stephen Simpson. Great pit stop by the bar one, guys. They've got Bruno out up a couple of places. He's just lost one of them.
That tells you something about the bar one guys and their pace. If Junqueira can't hold his position, been struggling for a little bit of setup. Brought Bruno back into the 20 team. Now they're doing all right, they're in fourth position, but I would have expected, well, I think they might have expected to be further up from where they are at the moment. Renger van der Zander on full attack mode at the moment, and the two leaders in prototype challenge, Tom Kimber-Smith and Renger, 34.8 and 34.8 in the first sector of this 4-mile circuit.
Here's this four-car GTD battle for the lead here. Viper still leads from the two Stevenson Audis again, so we're back to status quo as we were before the pit stops. And look at there in fourth place.
Jörg Bergmeister.
Jörg Bergmeister, that's right.
Loves this place. Absolutely loves this place. I remember possibly his first trip here when he was a Porsche junior driver, going down to Kola for a very pleasant meal with him, Timo, Sasha. Timo Bernard, Sasha Masson, Romain Dumas, I think, was there as well. They were all considerably younger, as was I. They were all raving about how great this circuit was, and that excitement for coming here has not waned one bit in the intervening 15 plus years. Well, Jeremy, half an hour to go. It's been a belter, hasn't it, already?
Yes.
But you get the feeling that there's a couple of twists to the end of this tail that we haven't yet seen.
Yeah, but Mazda, once again, you know, a distant fifth place now for Tristan Nunez, has to be said, doesn't it? Not much to choose between those two actual express cars. Once again, they've worked their way to the front, haven't they? And edging away a little bit now from Jordan Taylor in third place. A good lap by both of the two action express cars out front. 56-1 for Dane Cameron, but a 55-6 for Joao Barbosa. Just about a second between those two leaders.
Yeah, and that's good lap times from those guys now.
Yeah.
So unless there's a late race caution, once again, the pace shown by the 55 Mazda will have been for naught as far as the result is concerned. And they'll struggle now, I think, to even get on the podium.
Oh, yeah, there's no way. Unless there's a caution, there's no chance of getting on the podium.
66 Ford into the pits, well off the leader's pace at the moment. Joey Hunt taking over the car from Dirk Müller after Dirk had a broken suspension on that car early on. No contact reported by the team. GT Daytona then is where the action is at the moment. Get the feeling that Jerome Blakemolen is going to be very difficult to pass, even if Robin Liddell can get to him, which at the moment he isn't able to do. I'd have a sneaky little side bet, I think, on Ron Bergmeister in the 73 Porsche, who is at the moment just holding a watching brief in fourth position. Another 5 seconds further back, Alessandro Balzan in the 63. This is a circuit that Alessandro has never done particularly well at. Been here three or four times, but this will be a decent result for the 63 crew. Fancy their chances here with the Ferrari GT3. Leaders go past us, half a second between them at the start line, and now into turn one. Dan Cameron sliding the 31 car. Joao Barbosa is his teammate.
Yeah.
But we've heard before from Action Express, there's no team orders.
Well, that's right. I mean, and they're both battling for the championship, aren't they? They came into this race separated by 4 points. If it stays like it is, it'll be down to a 1 point margin with a couple of races remaining in the season. So Dane Cameron desperately wants to stay ahead of Joao Barbosa in this final. There's still half an hour to go in this race. There's a long, long way to go.
And let's not forget, as Shea has just reminded me, Jeremy, that these two last year got a little too close for comfort at this venue. Road America, IMSA, Sunday afternoon racing, half an hour to go, live on IMSA radio around the world. Our syndications including Sirius XM, thank you them for their airtime this afternoon and throughout the season. We'll continue with Sirius XM throughout the rest of the IMSA season.
Change for third place in GTD. Jörg Bergmeister just found a way past Lawson Aschenbach. That's number 73 car, the big German, the lanky German ahead of Lawson Aschenbach, who spoiled him this morning. He was really pumped up about this race, and they've had a great run once again, Stevenson Motorsports. They've been consistently right at the front here in GTD over the last four or five races.
I just said, didn't I, that Berg, the Bergmeister, big Jörg, was looking a bit racy, and he's chosen his point and gone through. Now just a second and a half behind Robin Liddell, who's a second behind Jerome Blakemolen as the leaders go past us again and again. It's going to be half a second.
Yeah, they're going to have to get past the
55.5 last time around for Nunez. This could be a rearguard action. 7 seconds to Oz Negri Jr. That's fourth place, but Oz has got quite a gap between himself and the podium. 20 seconds, I think, from memory, the last time I saw them go through. So this might be a great drive. Yeah, 26 seconds for Oz Negri to the podium. So over, still over 30 seconds for a Mazda to be on the podium here after they have dominated the timesheets all week. Leaders in traffic. Danger time then for Dane Cameron as there's a spin out there. And that's the fifth place PC car.
Bruno
Junqueira finding the bar one motorsports car difficult to keep on the track.
Yeah, he'd lost the position to Colin Brown a little while ago and under intense pressure from Kyle Marcelli, number 38 car. I think he was ahead of him before they had that spin. Whether there was anything between them, of course, I don't know.
Dane Cameron has used the traffic to his advantage. Joao Barbosa's a wee bit further back. Jordan Taylor getting a bit of a wiggle on as well. And at least holding his own, maybe a little better. Under 3 seconds now between the two Action Express cars at the front of the field. And Jordan Taylor in the number 10, Wayne Taylor Racing, matte dark grey Chevy Corvette prototype in third position.
And in PC, Tom Kimber Smith, car number 52 for PR1 Matheson Motorsports, he's extended his lead over the second place car, Renger van der Zanden, the championship leader. I'm sure Renger's got an eye on the championship here. Second place will be just fine. They've got a pretty handy lead, so there's no point doing anything silly.
Correct.
But it's certainly been a great effort here by Tom Kimber Smith and before that by Robert Alon in that number 52 car.
For our listeners on IMSA Radio and RadioLeMond.com, after the race, we'll continue to broadcast with Michelin Post Race Tech live from trackside. Get some more driver reaction. We'll share Adam over in Victory Circle area. Jeremy and I will stay on to go through your questions, points arising, or anything that you've noticed. So start getting your questions in now, please. We'll do the best to get through them. At IMSA Radio, hashtag Michelin PRT. At IMSA Radio on Twitter, hashtag Michelin PRT. And by the way, start thinking about your Spirit of the Race Award, our I Respect Spirit of the Race Award, for the person or persons who you think have most adequately displayed the endurance spirit or have added to the competition. Doesn't have to be a winner, often isn't, in fact. And that is again at IMSA Radio, hashtag RASOTR. Hopefully our administration heard those and will be able to track them for us. 25 minutes to go. I've got to say that the spirit of the race is going to be very difficult. Really good performances out here today. Really good performances. Alan Prosser quickly puts a note in for the helicopter pilot and camera operator. Quite often the heli-telly comes in for SOTRs, actually, particularly at the Nürburgring WEC. And we had some spectacular shots from there. Well, Jeremy, with 24 minutes to go then, spirit of the race for you? Somebody jump out at you? I quite like what Scuderia Corsa have done in the 63 car. Championship leaders have had to keep themselves in it, and they have. It was a very good drive early on in all the madness by Cristina. Alessandro Balzana certainly doesn't really like, but he's done the job. I think BMW have done a good job as well today, kept plugging along, starting from the back with the 125 car.
Yeah, Porsche's been a really good run for Porsche.
Well, yes, there you go.
Particularly with the struggles they've had up until now this season.
Jerome Blake and Molden.
Greasy Ferrari is closed right in.
Yeah.
In the battle for GTLM.
Yeah, well, there's another team who just keep digging. is it enough for the Spirit of the Race award? Our hometown pole sitter earlier on, James French.
Yeah, wasn't that cool?
Yeah, led the race as well.
Yeah, led the race overall.
There's a nomination perhaps. At IMSA Radio, hashtag RASOTR. RASOTR, Rotomaria SOTR. So RASOTR at IMSA Radio. And if you'd like to ask a question, put a point of order or something that you've noticed about any of this weekend's races here on the IMSA weekend at Rotomaria, that will be also at IMSA Radio, hashtag Michelin. PRT, Postgres Tech, PRT. João Barbosa refuses to be shaken off, but he hasn't made any real move either, Jeremy. And that, I mean, Jordan Taylor now within 2 seconds, he's just edging closer.
Well, he is on the last couple of laps. They've been working their way through some other traffic, and it's going to be the ebb and flow, isn't it, that we see on a regular basis, but certainly. Yeah, we've still got over 21 minutes remaining in this race now. And, the tyres are getting fairly used up. It's been a long green flag run. I think they all put on fresh tyres at the last stop. But still plenty of time to go.
Good morning to Sydney, Australia, particularly to Slade Perrins, who's listening into the end of this race on the bus on the way to school. Got to love time zones, haven't you, Slade? Thanks for tuning in. Let's go down to our Continental Tire pit lane reporter, Shea Adam.
Christian Fittipaldi, you did a great job in the five earlier, but now it's all up. Just wow. The trouble is, it's getting around your sister car, and there are no orders for Action Express, are there?
No, we just go racing. Like, obviously, the 31 is trying their very best, trying our very best. Respect is pretty big inside the team, and the team works very, very well together. So it's just another race like any other. Like, they're trying to win, we're trying to win, and let's see what happens at the very end.
Good luck.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, very important words there from Christian Fittipaldi. The low sun beginning to become an issue in the comms box and also out on the circuit. And Tony Wielander and Richard Westbrook really having a toe-to-toe battle at the moment. Let's not forget that 67 car started at the back of the field as well, Jeremy.
Indeed, but yeah, the margin was 4.2 seconds just after their last round of pit stops. That was about 10 laps ago. It's now, well, you can see it's just a couple of car lengths now. So Tony Wielander is right as close in on the Ford. Whether the Ford is just playing things cagey here, I don't know, because it's certainly looking strong in that middle stint of the race. Meanwhile, by the way, the battle for fourth place is on now because Tristan Nunez has caught up to Ozzie Negri.
Ah, yes.
One thing, of course.
Yeah, but still, Ozzie has not made any inroads at all into the leaders. No. He was 27 seconds away when I mentioned it before. He's 26.9 seconds away now.
Yeah, if anything, extended just sort of slightly over the last 7 or 8 laps.
GTD, well, Jerome Blakemore for a moment has a 2.5 second lead over Robin Liddell and Jörg Bergmeister. That's top three of Dodge, Audi and Porsche. Shouldn't be any worries on fuel for any of the GTLM cars, Jeremy.
Shouldn't be any worries for anybody on fuel, I don't think.
Lap 50 for the Ford, 49 for the Ferrari. They pitted last and have the best fuel mileage, 48-49 for Fred Macko and Nick Tandy.
The number 104 car absolutely side by
almost
side,
almost touching,
as they're being lapped by the race leader.
How that cool was that? Dave Cameron just lopes through on the inside as if they were all doing 25 miles an hour, and they're not, they're doing 175.
Jeepers, that was impressive.
I tell you what that is, though, Jeremy. We know when we talk about the RHGV Watts Club keys to the race, about not knowing people who are racing. That's the other side of that. That is complete trust on the two guys who are having their own battle from not only Dan Cameron, but the other two guys as well.
It isn't it just? And mean, he knows he's coming up on two GTLM cars there. He knows how professional those guys are. He knows they're paying attention to what goes. Even though they're battling amongst themselves, they're still perfectly aware of what's going around, behind them and then alongside them. Three abreast to turn one. That's not for the faint of heart.
It's not in the front. And it's two different categories of cars. It was the ease with which Dead Cameron went through, miles off the racing line. He was right-hand side Continentals, almost on the grass, so he's on completely the wrong racing line. Gets through, bit more than just a dab on the brakes, down a couple of gears, flicks the car in, and he's on the throttle and gone. Amazing composure from all three drivers. And remember, as Jeremy said, those guys are battling for fifth and sixth position in GTLM and valuable championship points. As through comes Joao Barbosa through that same piece of traffic, and Jordan Taylor, of course. He's just dropped away for a moment, but only by a couple of tenths. Tristan Nunez hasn't been able to get past Osvaldo Negri. And in fact, has dropped a couple of seconds there. Had a very slow lap last time around. 2:01.6 from Nunez. So I just wonder if Nunez has had a little whoopsie somewhere. What have Mazda got to do to win a race? They've overcomplicated their pit strategy here and gone off on a different road, a parallel course to the rest of the field, and they had the speed to win this race. I really would be interested to know what the thinking was behind what they did there. It may be something that we don't understand, Jeremy, and there may have been a very good reason for them doing it, but it looks odd from where we stand at the moment. The guys are going to be desperately disappointed again. And we don't see them again, of course, till the Circuit of the Americas. No prototypes at the VIR round. So they've got a long time to go away and do a bit of navel gazing about this one. Just a couple more races for the prototypes after this one, Road America and Road Atlanta. 55 car then in fifth position. Oz Negri Jr. ahead. Now, where did he have the issue earlier on? Well, he's locked up coming. Oh, I see what's happened. Down at the Canada corner area, tried to go inside the bar one.
It's Bruno, I think, isn't it?
Is that Bruno again? He's not having a good time at Bruno, is he? Passed by one of the prototypes and not the other. So that's where Tristan lost his couple or 3 seconds. Has he damaged the car on the left front? Comes out of the carousel. Looked fairly good there. Gets up in the top gear before he commits to the kink. More traffic ahead, and he's already almost made that gap back to Oz Negri. Already made that up. That is the pace that the Mazda has got. Balance of performance is so difficult, isn't it? When you look at results, Mazda might need a little bit of a hand to get back up there, but they've got the pace in the car. And a couple of mechanical issues. Just haven't had the strategy to win the races.
Where's the number 9 car for Los Nacional?
He's dropped off the pace a little bit. Alessandro's gone by, you are right. Has he had to pit? No, he hasn't.
It's a lap or two ago, but he's lost a couple of positions though lately.
He's lost, two positions. He was in, three positions. He was in third, wasn't he? So he's down to sixth there.
No, he got his fourth because he got past. We saw him get part overtaken by
Jörg Burmeister. Yeah. Quite correct. But Balzan and Andy Lally has gone through, and that's more good points for Scuderia Corsa. And GTD Championship leaders. Christina Nielsen will be watching on carefully. Just 0.8 of a second between Balzan and Andy Lally, who is charging back towards the front of the GTD field. By the way, just 5 seconds between the top five again now. That's all coming back together rather nicely for a grandstand finish in the last 13 minutes. On Sirius XM, as well as our syndications through IMSA.com, the IMSA app, and of course the Radio Show Limited network around the world. as we've got a prototype off, and it's the 85 car. Oh, goodness. Stephen Simpson has thrown away third place. He's gone off straight on at the carousel. Now, that will be full course caution. Now, that's a relatively easy recovery. Stephen's still in the car. This is going to pull it all back together for a dash for the cash here. The Continental Road Race Showcase at Road America in the main event for IMSA this weekend. And Stephen Simpson throws away a nailed-on podium.
Where's the number eight car as well?
Renger van der Zander. He has not come through either. Good point.
They weren't together. They weren't together on the racetrack, at least when they came past start-finish line on the previous lap.
There's van der Zander. He's in the same. He's in the same gravel trap. He's gone off as well.
That's the championship leader.
Oh my goodness, the championship, and he's looking rather pointedly across towards Simpson as he looks at the back right-hand side of the car. It was an odd place for Stephen to have gone off, in fairness. And I was about to say, I wonder if there's been some contact, and clearly there has. Simpson's gone straight to the scene of the accident, judging by the marks on the gravel trap on the driver's left at the carousel. Fabulous place to watch there. You can just get down to the outside. Yes. Watch those cars turning in at what seems ridiculous speed. Simpson's out of the car. Out of the car. So this is going to take a bit longer to clean up. Right, those cars. Is there somewhere where we can get those cars at the side of the track and out of the way? There is a gap in the arm core on the other side of the circuit, just after the Speedville Bridge. But it is on driver's right rather than driver's left, which is where both of them are. I think there's damage to the number eight car, Jeremy, that will require a rollback. In fact, the rollback is already there. Again, magnificent response by the recovery crews here. Well, put the headlines on hold, ladies and gentlemen. We may be working a little later tonight in the press room, as everything is about to be rewritten, possibly. Three full course cautions. Three cautions, full course cautions called by prototype challenge cars today. Jeremy makes a note for later.
Yeah.
Well.
I can't imagine what happened between those two, because when they came across to begin that lap, I certainly didn't have notes them having together. I had the number eight car ahead of the 85 car, I would say by a second or so. It certainly wasn't very much.
This from Mazda Racing, by the way, clearly listening in. Hi, guys. Strategy was based on the fact we believed the DPs were going to be tight on fuel. However, this yellow flag seems to solve that problem for the top three.
No, that's not an issue. They were good to go on fuel.
Well, Dane Cameron was the first of those cars to pit, and that was on lap 52. We're only on 68 now.
Yeah, which is about 43 minutes to go. That shouldn't be a problem. They can do 45, 46, 47 minutes. No, sorry. Don't buy that one. Nice try, though.
Well, that was one. It was one of our IHG Rewards Club keys to the race. The fuel numbers must add up, because we said you can't be one lap short and get back to the pit lane. But by the same token, you've got to watch what your competitors are doing, Jeremy, and be able to use their strengths or weaknesses to your best advantage.
Yeah, and you know, for number 55 car, certainly track position is a big key. When they came into that for that caution period and they didn't stop, they were in second place, and then we had the caution. They didn't pit, so took over the lead.
And they pulled out about 30 seconds, didn't they? Because the rest of the cars were behind the GTLM battle.
But that was
a roll of the dice at that point, and I just don't think it worked for them.
No, I mean, it would have put the pressure on the pit crew during that pit stop. Because they'd have had to, everybody was coming in together, so they'd have had to match everybody else and perhaps even try and beat the number five car it was at that stage out of the pit lane. But not to make that pit stop, and had the track position, pulled out a lead, but they weren't able to pull out enough of a lead to because if it had gone green from there to the, I mean, they at least have a chance now. Yes, they do have the fastest car on track, and they are now back up. They've got some lap cars between them, but a lot closer than they were prior to this full course caution. But yeah, no, unfortunately, it just didn't work out for them.
The Spirit of the Race Award, Slade Purred on that bus on the way to school in Sydney, Australia, listening in live on IMSA Radio, says my hashtag RASOTR vote goes for the fabulous track marshals and safety crews. That's a hard one to argue with, Slade. I'm honestly with that for not just this race, but across the weekend. Exemplary work has been done here by all the safety crews. Jeremy?
Actually, what's cool about the situation right now, with this, when this full course caution goes, there's no need for any wave arounds, because we've got all the prototype cars, or top six cars, are all prototype cars. The next six cars, five of them are PC cars, plus Delta Wing, which just had a pit stop a little while ago. And then we've got a couple of lap back to all the GTLM cars. And then we've got another one lap back to all the GTD cars. So, stand back.
Now, what do you do here, though? Do you open the pits and let everybody pit? Nobody needs to pit,
do they? No one needs to pit, so...
So we should be able to go back to green.
Yeah, but they probably do have to...
If you open the pits here, then we finish under yellow, don't we? With six minutes to go?
Yes, true.
Because then you've got to reset the field after that.
Yeah. It shouldn't be any. Hopefully they can... there's no need for any... nobody needs a pit stop, so... nobody significant needs a pit stop in any case. And hopefully they can get these cars out of the way. But I'm still curious to know what happened between those two, I must say.
So the flatbed is coming round. The safety car, the flatbed is pulling off the driver's right to get off the circuit as quickly as possible into the area by the motorplex, the kart circuit. And it looks to me as though the safety car lights are out, Jeremy.
It does, doesn't it? Yeah.
So I think we're going back to green. So quick yellow called by the officials, so there'll be no reshuffling of the field, no opening of the pit lane. The pit lane will open as we go back to green. A couple of GTLM cars, in fact, first and second in GTLM, behind first and second in the race.
Yeah.
Now that's going to be interesting.
Cars right behind there as well. So that's the bad news for the Mazda, by the way, because there's all these other class leaders in between them and everybody else.
You've got half a dozen or eight cars.
I reckon it should be time here for three laps, I think, for the end of this race, I hope.
Stand by, ladies and gentlemen. If you're sitting on the seat, move to the edge of it, because this is go time. Leave nothing in the cabinet. Green, 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 called on the pitch radio, and everybody is up to speed for the final time, we hope, as we make the dash to the line for the Continental Tire Road Race Challenge here for the IMSA WeatherTech Sports Car Championship. And first and second in GTLM are having a real go down into turn one. Richard Westbrook and Tony Vierlander. And just add in one Nick Tandy, who's right there. And so is the second Porsche, and so is the Corvette, as well as the PC leaders.
Those tires, he's not as quick as he would like to be. The Ferrari's right there, the Porsche is there as well. Three different manufacturers, one, two, three.
Down towards, bump drafting, down through the Kingard Ford, down towards turn five. The Ford right on the inside gets a nudge from Vierlander. They're both going to go off, and Nick Tandy's going through to the lead. He's hit. Tandy's hit by the Ford as he was going through to the lead. Nick Tandy gets turned around from third to first to nothing for Nick Tandy, and the great comeback of Porsche that we'd been hoping for is done with 3 minutes and 55 seconds to go. Ooh, Westbrook is going to be seething because he was nearly pushed out of the lead there by Vierlander. But he's slow, and Vierlander has a look around the outside of the carousel as they pass by the prototype challenge leaders. Westbrook struggling under braking and acceleration clearly with that Ford. And now it's a Corvette, and it's the Corvette of the Tommy Milner who's got ahead of Fred Macko. So that's another change behind these leaders, and there's more touches and dust in the air behind.
You've got to laugh, haven't you? I mean,
could we not have just stopped before, please? That was... Oh, I'm hearing a big no from everybody around the world.
Absolutely right.
Extraordinary restart with the leaders in three different classes having to fight their way through respective cast battles. No sign of the white flag. There'll be one more at the end of this one. First, second and third, by the way, absolutely together, 31, 5 and 10. Jordan Taylor's back in the fight here. He's only a second away from the leader. The two Action Express cars have got back up to speed. They're in clear air now at the head of the field. Tristan Nunez has got past Osnegri Jr. and is in fourth position. And there's another touch. And that is a Ford. Now, is that which Ford is it that's gone around? No, it's the Ferrari. It's the Ferrari that's gone around. And Wieland has been pushed out of second position by a prototype. Now, I have to say, with the low sun here, I did not see who that was. So Corvette down to second place. Where's the other Porsche gone? Fred Magnus dropped back to fifth. He's had a terrible restart.
There's been all sorts of shuffling also at GTD. The Viper still leads, but Jörg Bergmeister up to second place.
I thought he had something in that car.
Alessandro Valls down there right with him, and Robin Liddell and Andy Lally.
So
there's another 25 BMW problem.
Dirk Vernon coming in from the back of the GTLM field. Now, which prototype or prototype challenge car was it that pushed Wielander out there at turn one?
The white flag this time around. We had the three overall leaders, by the way, absolutely nose to tail around.
Yes.
I don't know where they are on the racetrack now.
They're coming back to us now. 25 was out of fuel, I've been told by our Continental Tire pit lane reporter. As Tristan Nunez clears the battle in GTLM, but is too far back to get on the podium. Oh my goodness, what a finish to this race. We're going to have Ford, Chevy and BMW on the podium. You would not have bet that even 5 minutes ago.
Yeah, which order?
Well, there is that. Terrible restart from the two, well, from Fred Magno. Nick Tandy's still running, but down the field. The two Action Express cars now take the white flag, still like half a second apart. I think they're holding station now. Sorry, I just had to give it a try. I just had to try it out, see how it sounded. Doesn't work at all, does it?
Two Nunez on that lap.
Nunez has gone back behind Osvaldo Negri, hasn't he? So he's dropped a couple of seconds there. So the bad day for Mazda goes to worst.
So it's Corvette now second.
Yep. BM third. Corvette's first, second and third at the head of the field. Oh, and hang on a second. This is not over yet because there's another lap for these guys. As they go under the bridge, the checkered flag is coming out in front of us and it's side by side for the GTM lead. And the Corvette's gone through. The Corvette's gone through. Out to turn three. A brilliant piece of driving by Tommy Milner. And it's all changed again. And no one can believe this, not even Corvette. Richard Westbrook is not going to even hold on to second here. I fancy the BMW has got something. Again, the Ford struggling to get up to speed after the restart.
Yes.
Saw that in the early part of the season. It was really prevalent. I thought they'd got over that.
And the Corvette was fifth at the restart. It's now leading this race on the final lap.
And Porsche will be kicking themselves. They could have had this victory. They could and should have had this victory.
They're not even going to be on the podium now because the BMW is up into third place.
Correct. Fred Magnus had a shocker on the restart. Action Express, first and second. We said early on the weekend, Jeremy, never count them out. They've stayed off the curbs. They've made the cautions count. They've done the right numbers on the fuel. And they have played the game. The IHG Rewards Club keys to the race have favoured them, their strategy and their execution, and the 31 brings home the win for Action Express. We'll stay with the action on the track before we go to the pit lane for reaction. And is Richard Westbrook going to hold on to second place? I think he is, you know. He covers the inside immediately coming off the final corner, but this is win number 101 for Corvette Racing, and a most extraordinary and unexpected one at that. Tommy Milner wins it for Chevy Corvette from Westbrook, who drove a very, very good race. And what about John Edwards in the number 100 BMW? The 67 and the 100 coming from the back of the grid. Porsche in fourth place any other weekend would have been delighted, but they had a race victory in their sights and it disappeared. And what about the 62? Tony Wielander spun out of a challenging position for the win of the race. It's Viper again in GTD. The big front engine car loves this place.
Great effort by that team.
Jörg Bergmeister coming through from sixth with about half an hour to go. Got himself up into fourth, then third, and then into second. And the 73 Park Place Porsche comes through. And the championship leaders, Jeremy, have quietly gone about their business. And the 63 Ferrari up into third position. Continental Tire pit lane report from Corvette. He's here, Adam, 101.
I'm not even sure you'll be able to hear me in here, John. There is so much elation. Everybody's saying, I can't believe it. And Ollie Gavin, who came off of the Pratt perch and was stunned. Ollie, incredible. You didn't think that was going to happen 5 minutes ago, let alone 5 seconds.
No, that is just extraordinary finish. Amazing job by Tommy. The crew, the strategy at the end there. It just seemed like the car came alive. We made a change in that last stop, and it just brought the car alive. And it's what we've been missing in the first part of the race. I don't think Tommy can believe it. You know, we were looking at like fifth at best, and then all of a sudden that caution came and it just mixed everything up, and there was contact and crazy stuff happening, and it's just wonderful. I mean, this is such an amazing result for us, and it's big, big, big for the championship. So thrilled.
It's the sixth different manufacturer win in 6 years, and Corvette's first since 2008 at this track.
Wow. Amazing stuff. Well, got to tell you that Nick Tandy was on his way to a victory there.
Well, yes.
But he got tapped.
Yes, but he used up all the road on the exit there. He really didn't need to, honestly, because he had the momentum. If he'd have breathed it just a little bit, he'd have got away with that. Now, who was that, Nick?
Is that the 31 car? No, it can't be. Oh, it was the Mazda.
I thought the Mazda
55.
Was struggling.
Oh, dear.
What a dreadful day again for Mazda.
And ruins the race of Risi Competizione. Yeah. I'll be surprised they don't get called for that, to be honest, Jeremy. Well, that was second place.
And Westbrook as well, because he pushed the Ferrari unnecessarily really down to five, didn't he? And Nick Tandy there, if he'd been an ounce less, more patience, because he saw what was happening. If he'd given a little bit more room on the exit, which really could have done, he had the momentum. He could take whatever line he liked, but the other two cars didn't want to run off the road, so they did nothing wrong, and he kind of drifted out into the Ferrari and the Ford that were battling amongst themselves. And
he could have just pinched that half a yard.
Anybody could have won that race in GTO,
absolutely.
Which is what we said, isn't it?
Yes.
Two hours and 40 minutes ago.
I'm just about to tear everything up and start again. How do you write that one up in 600 words, Jeremy?
Well, I mean, remarkably. So the overall win, Dane Cameron, Eric Curran, as it was last year.
Yeah.
In PC, we've got a new leader there with PR1, Mathis Mosewells. Excellent job by them. In GTLM, we've got the Corvette winning. Rather than the Porsche from last year. In GTD, the Viper is out front again. Tremendous stuff.
Don't forget your questions for Michelin PRT, hashtag Michelin PRT to at IMSA Radio. And Spirit of the Race Award, throw that one up
cool
in the air after that last
after that.
Couple of laps. Hashtag RASOTR again at IMSA Radio. Cher Adam, I just want to have a quick word with you. I know you're hustling back to get some interviews. It sounded to me as if the guys at Corvette didn't know whether to laugh, cheer, cry, or whatever. That was an extraordinary finish.
The answer to that is yes. They were doing all of that.
All of those. All of the above.
They didn't know when 100 was going to come, and it came at Lime Rock. They really didn't know when 101 was going to come, and they really didn't think it was going to be today. Doug Vehan and Gary Pratt both were over the moon with this one. And John, I'm just running over to the podium now in its new location, of course, and I'll let you know when I got more interviews.
Thanks, Shep. Now, for those at the circuit here, we're going to hand the PA, the public address system, back to our colleagues for the formalities. We'll continue on 454 even and on IMSA Radio and our affiliates and syndications, including XM Sirius. Thanks for your company on those. And, of course, on RadioLeMond.com, we continue with Michelin PRT. Thanks for being with us here at Road America. Our IMSA coverage continues. at VIR in a couple of weeks' time. For Shea, for Jeremy, I'm John Hindorf. Thanks to the guys back in London and the responsible adult as well. You've been listening to the Continental Tire Road Race Showcase live on IMSA Radio.